And I am coming to you live from deep in the heart of Texas, Austin. We'll be here for the next 4 hours. I'm your host, Alex Jones, on this Monday, the 29th day of August, 2016. Thematically, every day, looking at hundreds and hundreds of news stories, a theme will emerge. And more often than not, the number one theme is global censorship of news and information. Many people will look at the collapse of the dinosaur media and the collapse of its credibility as something positive, and I do overall, but really now, what do they have to lose? They have only intensified and then intensified again and then intensified again and again and again the unification of deception and twisting information. But we have parallel media that is exposing it in real time. The next logical move for them to engage in is the takeover and the shutdown of that media. We were warned last year, like right around this time of year, by Matt Drudge, that he was told massive censorship was coming to the internet this year. And now we have even the Wall Street Journal today, an internet giveaway to the UN. The agreement with ICANN has been kept secret. And now they've gotten parts of it, and it is the turnover to the UN. And that dovetails with the fact that we have new documents from the Daily Caller. We need to do a unified story about this. Soros document, regulate internet to favor open society supporters. We've already seen the wave, the army, the constellation, the force of socialist, globalist, communist, world government pushers on everything from Facebook to Twitter to Google to Alexa being boosted, and anyone who is for an open free society being delisted, basically being shown to have no viewers or visitors, even as your traffic spikes. Unified deception. So he calls for this in the emails. This is already going on. Germany and France are just a few years ahead of where we're at. Chinese-style communist censorship is the global goal. So you look at the theme just today. This is just a small smattering. An internet giveaway to the UN. Wall Street Journal. And they go into it and they say, it's unbelievable. The conspiracy theorists are right. It's a UN takeover. We're not conspiracy theorists. We know the globalist plan. We have the emails, after all. Soros document, regulate internet to favor open society supporters. When they say open society, they mean global government overrunning your national sovereignty, installing tyranny. Just look at that demon in that photo, your TV viewer. And meanwhile, AP reports Pope Francis chats in person with Zuckerberg, CEO of Facebook. That's right, they're organizing everything together. He's calling for censorship, the Pope is, saying Europe being Christian is abhorrent, disgusting. These are quotes. BBC, Europe migrant crisis, Germany expects 300,000 a year, that means a million. But let's look at these little Soros stories. DC leaks website down, Twitter suspended after releasing Soros stocks. Oh, the website gets hacked and taken down. Twitter suspends. Unified shutdown. Nice little testes. And then, meanwhile, here's another one for you. Infowars.com. Huffington Post bans journalists who's written for them for years for writing about Hillary's health, deletes article, an article that simply pointed out that one of Watson's videos alone has over 4 million views and that it's a national issue. And you know what? He's been terminated, and the story's been deleted. Oh, and then I've got more censorship straight ahead. In the third hour, I have a former Huffington Post writer of many years who dared to link to an article by Paul Joseph Watson and a video that had over 4 million views looking into Hillary's health. Now, this has been covered on CNN. The video has been covered on Fox News. The video was first posted by DrudgeReport.com about a week and a half ago and since went viral. and has been seen by tens of millions because it's been aired on network TV. But the writer at the Huffington Post, they had to be censored, they had to be fired, they had to be shut down for that, because you dare not speak about Hillary Clinton's health. Now, thematically, there's a lot of news to cover here today, but this is what's happening. We are seeing the emergence of the global government agenda. The robber barons of the 19th and 20th century are not establishing world governments so they just run everything. They're control freaks and have a particular system they want to impose called technocracy, in their own words, for over 100 years. And the technocracy is to impose the global philosophy of eugenics, but not the eugenics that is just one spectrum that has been taught in schools, but the true, full eugenics, which is basically your animals, you are the Eloi, they are the Morlock. And H.G. Wells wrote nonfiction books admitting that that was an allegory for the ruling class and the general public. So is War of the Worlds. It's an allegory of the elite versus the people. Go read his book, The New World Order, or Things to Come, and you will understand. I would get up on air 15 years ago, I remember, and I had a copy of the textbook somewhere here around the office. And I would show TV viewers, I would read for radio listeners, the Calhoun Reader, that's what it's called, that was being used at the University of Texas and hundreds of other universities around the United States, that actually said, the trainer for social workers, that actually said, the family belongs to an age of barbarism and must be eradicated. Now, a few months ago, there was another article out in mainstream news, and it was saying, basically, well, we're going to allow the family for a while as a management group for the state, but parents will just be wards of the state, and their children are wards. Just incredible, 100% absolute cult level total nightmare government. And I would read that on air, and radio listeners would not believe me that the University of Texas, miles from where I'm broadcasting, teaches the family is barbarous and primitive. Those are terms they use, page after page, and how it must be eradicated. Because it is in the parents passing knowledge down that we have all the ignorance of the world. No, that's humanity. And now the technocrats want that totally broken. Paul Joseph Watson has an article. I'm going to get to this first, and then I'm going to get to the huge censorship taking place. This is just one part of the emergence on every front. Black Lives Matter, this is so apropos, vows to destroy the nuclear family in favor of communitarian collective care. Remember, George W. Bush launched the communitarian movement. Everybody freaked out about it who was informed, because it means communities of communism. Now, you have to understand, this isn't some fringe group. This is what George Soros funds, and I'm going to tie it in globally here in a moment. What happened to the black community in the 1950s and 60s when, on average, these are factual numbers, black communities had the lowest illegitimacy in the United States of America? Who had the highest? Native American groups on reservations, because they had been under government control. Government money comes in and says you can't have a man in the house. Within a few decades, we go from less than 5% of black homes being single family, single parent, to 75%, and now it's over 85% on average. Devastating numbers. We know if there's not a father or a mother in the house, either one, you are three times more likely to end up on drugs, four times more likely to end up in prison. You are going to earn massively less. You're probably not going to finish high school. We know this. And here's Black Lives Matter, the product of the brainwashing, out here with their signs saying we are committed. This is from their website. to disrupting the Western prescribed nuclear family. No, that's how humans operate from Japan to, that's how civilization operates. We are committed to disrupting, this is what they're doing, they admit it, the Western prescribed nuclear family structure required by supporting each other as extended families and villages. Everybody by themselves with a central government village system that can be changed any day, that collectively care for one another and especially our children, that means your children belong to the state, to the degree that the mother, parents, and children are comfortable. Notice, don't mention men in that. And that's because the state wants you weak, women. They want you all alone. And they want the men to never become men so that you absolutely are disgusted with them, and then they can put out the image of an uncaring, mindless, arrested development thug, be they white, black, you name it. Everybody sees it everywhere. A cynical, narcissistic, stupid, cowardly male that thinks having no responsibility, having no honor is powerful. That thinks an aura of arrogance and selfishness is a crown upon their head. This is the fall of the human species by design. Just as H.G. Wells, top futurist of the Fabian Social Society, said he would do. George Orwell was in the Fabians as well, very elite. It was so evil, he wrote 1984 warning you, and wrote letters publicly published in newspapers saying his book was the reality of what he learned at the BBC and in British intelligence and in the Foreign Secret Service. And he was dead less than a year it came out. I'm just telling you that again. You read that book. Not to make us stronger, not to make us better, to end the family, to take children from their parents like you take eggs from a hen. Those are quotes. North Korea actually does it. Why is it the same program all over the world, run by fascists, run by communists, run by corporatists? Because it's a plan to end us, to turn us into animals like factory farm chickens or pigs. And if we act like it, we deserve it. Now, they know that at the point of this global government emerging, they're not going to be able to hide it anymore. For decades, they denied any of this was happening, any of this was going on. You go back 60 years, everything Barry Goldwater wrote has become true. Not because he was a rocket scientist, he was smart, but because he was in the Senate intelligence meetings where they were telling him, the Ford Foundation, the Carnegie Foundation, the Rockefeller Foundation, all came in and submitted reports to Congress, and Congress followed their every word. We are under a planetary program that the United States with England launched against the globe. And you got to hand it to them. They're running the whole show, baby, while sucking us dry to build it. See, you don't ignore this if you're a new viewer or listener. This is fact. This is a program. It's not my opinion. I'll use the allegory again. It's like cops busting in to the serial killer's house because they found a dead body in their car, and they go down and there's videotapes, VHS tapes, of them torturing 20, 30, 40 different women and chopping them up and burying them under the floorboards, and then a journal, how he did it, when he did it, when he picked them up. It's open and shut. I have to sit here metaphorically every day digging up more of the bodies. They don't even hide them. And then I get to tell the public what's going on. People go, oh, that's your opinion. No, this is not my opinion. Let me continue. Remember 20 years ago the Patriots said they want to break up the family and they want to hurt your kids and they want to make us all poor? Oh, shut up, you conspiracy loon. Now they just go on MSNBC and say, your kids don't belong to you. We need to break through that notion. It belongs to all of us. But see, first they said don't discipline your own kids and don't have your neighbors discipline. They actually ended that real village community. They mean the state community, because there is a village community, but they create a counterfeit on top of that. But the village community is like if the cops, when my dad was growing up, caught, my dad wasn't really a delinquent or anything, but you know, if it was his brother, I guess, got caught stealing watermelons just for fun, the cops would just beat you up. And by the way, tell your parents that they did it. I'm going to beat you too hard. But the whole point is, that's because you're going to get hurt even worse the next time you do something a little worse. They take all the authority out of the local area. They put it right to the central system. Chaos breaks out. And then the central system that has the monopoly on the authority comes in to take over. I'm skipping this break because we're not going to even have a show soon if this continues. So we have to just absolutely sacrifice and illustrate blood, sweat, treasure, tears here on air to illustrate to you how dire the straits are. It's like when 9/11 happened, for days they didn't run radio ads. Remember that? Because it wouldn't be proper to do during an emergency. I don't even know how we're supposed to run ads during this long emergency. It's like not freaking out on air, not getting animated. Ads into everybody's trance. We should all be freaking out over this. Let's play Melissa Harris Perry, remember, saying, your kids don't belong to you. From MSNBC.
We have never invested as much in public education as we should have, because we've always had kind of a private notion of children. Your kid is yours and totally your responsibility. We haven't had a very collective notion of these are our children. So part of it is we have to break through our kind of private idea that kids belong to their parents or kids belong to their families and recognize that kids belong to whole communities. Once it's everybody's responsibility and not just the households, then we start making better investments.
And notice, they take your money, they give you jobs where it's hard to pay for everything. Your kids are in front of TV all day, they're eating bad food, all these dyes, all these chemicals, they're acting bad. Mom wants to go out at night. She wants to leave them at the gymnasium till 8 or 9. But see, now your children are totally raised by the state. And now the final phase is coming in, and they have George Soros funding black groups that are actually asking for a return to slavery, where there weren't even men in the household and the women were brought into the house and the men were kept out in the barn. Now the men are kept in the prison or in the state system and the women come and get jobs with the state. They have just recreated the Roman Empire slave system. You're thinking, wait, I thought you were talking about black people. That was just an extension of the Roman plantation system, which had people of every color and creed. In fact, black slaves were more expensive, if you read the histories, and harder to get, so they were more prestigious in Rome. It was mainly folks from Gaul and Germania and other areas that were the cheaper slaves. But see, the general public doesn't know all this, so you're looking at actual slavery being brought in as a right. And they're saying, we are dedicated, we are committed to, that's the quote, we are committed to disrupting the Western prescribed nuclear family structure required by supporting each other as extended families and villages that collectively care for one another and especially our children to the degree that mothers, parents, and children are comfortable. And they will define what you're comfortable with in a collective. So, that's what's being vomited out. That's what's being spewed. Now, let me get into the big theme that we see emerge. Because I don't come here with my theme every day. I look at what the globalists are doing and I cover that theme. Let me just give you some headlines here. An internet giveaway to the UN, Wall Street Journal. They actually got the documents. It's going to happen in less than 2 months, and it actually gives the UN control. And guess what? The UN says they're going to censor everybody, as Facebook and others are already doing in Europe. In fact, Facebook is being recruited to run the program intergovernmentally as an NGO. Oh, and then the next article, that's Wall Street Journal. Daily Caller, just this is today. Soros document, undisputed. Regulate internet to favor open society supporters. Give them the traffic, give them the support, give them the advertisers. Let them operate, let them have businesses, let them have shops. Back when he first was aiding the Nazis in Eastern Europe as a teenager, first the people they were suppressing, whether it was Jews and many other groups, they wouldn't let you have your shop operate anymore. You had to go be poor now and sell your house to them for nothing and then move on to the ghetto after that. First, they made you poor to control you. Where have I heard of that before? Just like they've doubled black unemployment under Obama in 8 years. See, it's a program. And then they start shutting you off economically where you can't operate. Oh, they won't let Christians or conservative groups have 501c3s. They won't let veterans groups have 501c3s. They won't let libertarian groups have 501c3s. They won't let have law enforcement fraternal organizations that are patriotic have 501c3s. First, they won't let you have access to the tax exemption. Then they start auditing you. They start persecuting you. And MSNBC gets up there and says, you deserve it, Tea Party. You're racist. We just dehumanized you. And they go on to say, shut down the freedom of expression and only allow our NGOs to operate. Go read the document for yourself. Now, Pope Francis has been meeting with Zuckerberg, AP reports, to help push their agenda. Now that dovetails with this, doesn't it? DNC website down, Twitter suspended after releasing Soros docs. Oh, that website gets shut down. Twitter works in unison. You got to silence them all. Shuts down their Twitter. See, it's already operating. Already. Oh, you release those documents, and then George Soros makes sure it gets shut down. And DC Leaks wasn't big enough for it to get any attention. They should have been sending us the info, but that's fine. They sent it to WikiLeaks. That's great. WikiLeaks has enough clout to get it out. The media is forced to cover it. And oh, the crimes they talk about in there. Oh, there's another one. I've got stacks of these. Not even looking. Stacks and stacks. Remember Dr. Drew, less than a week after a hit show on Headline News? He comes out and says, I care about Hillary. Man, she's the medicines they say they're giving her and her medical records that they put out, Coumadin and armor thyroid from the 60s, haven't been given since then. This would kill you. This doesn't make sense. I'd like to talk to her doctors. I want to help her. Boom, you're fired. Because they got control of CNN. After all, it is the Clinton News Network. Isn't that just special? We have that reporter joining us coming up in the third hour. The Huffington Post has sensationally censored an article pertaining to questions about Hillary Clinton's health and banned the journalist who wrote it from posting on their website altogether. David Seaman penned a commentary piece discussing questions surrounding Hillary Clinton's health problems on Sunday. The story included a link to my viral video. This is Paul Watson writing about the subject. It has 3.5 million views. It's got 4 million now. The post, which has been trending, the number 3 on the website, was deleted within hours. Oh, yeah. And Seaman's post rights were completely revoked. Let me ask real liberals a question, because I know you're out there. You were the folks that marched with me against the Iraq war. You were the folks that supported, you know, us against, you know, lying about WMDs. I mean, you're the type of people that I disagree with on some issues, but you're not bloodthirsty fascists. Do you understand that if you go to the Wall Street Journal or even the New York Times or the Washington Post, but even the Wall Street Journal, you'll have 50 articles, 60 articles. This weekend, I saw on CNN's front page over 100 articles, and so there were 60 plus, I counted them up, that were on Trump, and all of them were negative. All of them. This isn't even about Trump. It's the unified control of the dinosaur media and everyone in lockstep. This is shameful. They're getting ready for new banker bailouts. It's being announced. New looting of the taxpayers. They'll all go along with it. They'll go along with any new wars the establishment starts, and they'll go along with intensified persecution of anyone that's pro-America, anyone that isn't a traitor, anyone that doesn't want race war, anyone that doesn't want to shoot cops in the back of the head when they're changing tires or pumping gas, anyone who isn't a mindless scumbag servant of George Soros. We are in such incredible peril right now. And the stacks go on and on and on with the censorship now happening. And people say, well, how are you still on air? Google will not let me sell my films or have a shopping cart. For 7 years, they said, you made a film called Obama Deception. It is racist. You are banned. I am banned from commerce on Google, the biggest platform in the world. Oh, people say, so what? See, it's going to hit you next. And they're going to go after everybody in the end, folks. And I could go on and on and on and on and on. We have so many platforms, and we're on close to 200 AM and FM affiliates, TV stations, cable, you name it, that we've got a big enough presence that we're hard to go after. They had to infiltrate and take Fox over from within. They tried to do boycotts on Limbaugh and had him, falsely arrested and all that other crap. This is the type. I mean, they're not playing, folks. If I told you, and I don't want to be dramatic here, and it doesn't bother me. I expect it to happen. My life is like a James Bond movie. Okay, I have dealt with stuff you couldn't believe. Okay, you've seen what's happened here on air. You see what we do. And it's only because we have the will to do it and built the platform to resist. And there are a lot of patriots in the government and in corporate systems that appreciate what we're doing and are helping us. But and you out there, the listeners, and your prayers. But you have to understand, it's not hyperbole. It's not rhetoric. It's not hype. We have outrageous levels of evil. We have Obama persecuting more journalists than all presidents in U.S. history combined. Whistleblowers who report serious crime are arrested and thrown in maximum security prisons. Evil is moving. against the world. Our government destabilized scores of non-radical Muslim nations and put the most horrible, bloodthirsty jihadis in control to murder every Christian and non-radical Islam person they could. They call them heretics, Alawites, Shiites, and others. They kill them. Hundreds of thousands. Hillary makes jokes about, I came, I saw, he died. Madeleine Albright says, I don't care if 500,000 Iraqi kids die. These are bloodthirsty monsters, and they're moving. Hillary puts out a fundraiser press release 2 weeks ago. Doesn't even hide it. And says, Breitbart doesn't have a right to exist. Neither does the alt-conservative media. We're going to shut it down when I get in. Then she gives a speech last week and names yours truly as enemy number one, basically. I tell you, I know everybody out there is basically starting to have the light bulb go on above their head and realize, oh my God, this whole world government's really real. And at the bottom of the world government rat hole is basically a big, fat, diseased moray eel that feasts on civilizations and innocent people. This whole thing's being set up as a giant power trip for very, very sick, very, very twisted globalist interests that do not have our best interests at heart. And they openly are saying, you can't have your family, you can't have your private property. A canary in the coal mine is all over the world, from South America to the United States. Amish and Mennonite communities are now being harassed, demonized, and attacked by central government. They don't want anybody operating outside their system. By the way, the Amish and Mennonites do not have autism. Their cancer rates are incredibly lower, and it's because they don't use modern chemicals and pesticides. The elite can't have one group of rats in the laboratory that are not being poisoned, and the other rats right next door are all dying at half their age and diseased with tumors all over. Because if the rats are humans, they got brains big enough to look over there at the Amish and go, something's going on. You got it, folks? The New World Order is here to kill you and your family. But first, dumb you down, make you sick, and suck everything out of you. And when people finally get it, that this has not been rhetoric or exaggeration, when you finally get it, is the minute we start turning the tide against these people. And I want to explain. The average person in government or corporations is just as compartmentalized as the public and is not the enemy. It is the New World Order and the philosophy of the technotronic technocracy to enforce eugenics. Those are the words of Zbigniew Brzezinski, the words of Henry Kissinger, the words of Carol Quigley, the words of John P. Holdren, the words of the architects. I got the blueprints. You can have the blueprints. You got to read what they wrote, though, to know it's real. You can't sit there in cognitive dissonance and say, oh, this guy's wild-eyed. How am I supposed to not be wild-eyed when they're on TV saying we're going to get rid of the family and they're incrementally raising taxes and regulations and control where it's almost impossible to have one, and they create cultural systems to make kids act as bad as they possibly can? I'm going to go back into the news and just get into so much. Briefly, we've never sold more of the Hillary for prison shirts, and I know why. We're selling them at cost. The shipping and handling is included, $9.95. In fact, on some of the 4Xs and stuff, there's some big boys out there buying them. We actually lose about a dollar on those because they do cost us more. The shirts have like twice the fabric. But on average, it's at cost, and I can only run this for another week or so, but it is extremely popular. We're going to go to another design soon, so it's also limited edition. And we're calling this the Dark Heart Special because Hillary Clinton came out, of course, last Thursday and said that I have such a horrible, evil, dark heart because I don't trust her and don't like her. And so people are responding. We need to see Hillary for Prison shirts everywhere. We have millions of listeners. If millions of you would order the shirts instead of 100,000 or whatever have done it, imagine the effect that would have. And I would just have a third-party clearinghouse actually ship it, you know, at that point, if we start selling hundreds of thousands a month instead of hundreds of thousands in a year. We need to put millions of these out. We can do it. We're ready. If every one of you just says, I'm getting a Hillary for President shirt at cost and maybe buys two or three more to give to friends and family and others, we can really send a hardcore message that's already shaken up the globalist and shaken up Hillary. After all, you know, Hillary just had to hold her heart when she talked about how horrible and dark my heart is.
What happens when you listen to the radio host, Alex Jones, who claims that 9/11 and the Oklahoma City bombings were inside jobs? He even said, and this really just is so disgusting.
Oh, yeah.
He even said the victims of the Sandy Hook massacre were child actors and no one was actually killed there. I don't know what happens in somebody's mind or how dark their heart must be to say things like that. But Trump doesn't challenge these lies. He actually went on Jones's show and said, your reputation is amazing. I will not let you down. This from the man who wants to be president of the United States.
All right, let's stop right there. I'm going to go to the latest Trump clip in a moment where he talks about the NSA has her emails. Well, we have the former head of the NSA on this show, so Trump's right. And I have other clips, but I want to play a clip in a moment. It's the Goblin clip to show you how they can take something out of context and twist it. 9/11 was an inside job in that criminal elements of our government working with the Saudis and others ordered a stand down on 9/11. We do not know the exact specifics of what happened, but we know that high-level whistleblowers have come on this show, Lexie Bell Edmonds, the FBI translator, and others, and broke down what was in the congressional report. She testified to Congress in secret that there was bare minimum a stand down. That's an inside job. To then attack a country, Iraq, that wasn't even involved, to take out an enemy of Saudi Arabia, to then go into Syria, and you see the battlefield. Oklahoma City was a false flag, absolutely, with bombs inside the building, with a patsy out front. We have the local news showing the bombs being taken out. I've interviewed the police officers that had the feds come and threaten to kill them, Don Browning and others. They didn't shut up. Some cops got killed. That is a true statement, her only true statement, that I said that is a pure false flag. I went and searched this weekend to find where they were getting this, and they did edit together a clip where I say, you know, I can't believe they just have actors and not kill kids. I mean, I know there was a blue screen with Anderson Cooper, and they might have had some adults that were actors because they've been caught doing that before, but, I can't believe that they didn't, you know, kill any, you know, kids at this thing. I mean, there are real mass shootings sometimes. Just statistically, they're not that common, but I said, man, look at it, the kids going in circles in and out of the building, you know, during this drill. It looks like a drill. I mean, yeah, I guess they could have been actors. That's a hypothetical statement. But the point is, I don't run from that. You guys lied about WMDs. You guys bomb aspirin factories when you know Clinton's about to be impeached to divert people. You lied about Serbia and who started that whole war and bombed them twice and then engaged in all these other crimes and talk about, you know, you went to Libya, you came, you saw, he died. 60, 70-something thousand people dead with the jihadis you brought in, killing men, women, and children. So you sit there talking about how I'm evil and I'm bloodthirsty, twisting what I've said. It's truly disgusting. But here's an example of how they twist something. I used a Lord of the Rings analogy, and I said, you know, Trump's going to get dirty fighting these goblin-like creatures. And if he's got to go down a goblin nest and, you know, fight some, he might get some goblin guts, goblet vomit on him, goblin blood, but I don't want to catch him in bed with a goblin or kissing a goblin. They went on all over the news, TV, newspapers, you name it, and said Alex Jones is worried about Donald Trump having sex with goblins. And people could say, Alex, watch what you say. They can spin it or twist it. That's what they do. It's why they're discredited. I'm not reading off a teleprompter, and I don't apologize for it. Trump always said they make it really hard for legal people to come here. I will make it easier as long as you're vetted and don't have a criminal record. You'll have to go out and then come right back in. But if you're a felon, we're going to throw you out. There's a lot of bad people coming in from Mexico and other areas, a lot of big problems. They turn that into he hates Mexicans and is going to kick everybody out. Then he comes out and, again, restates what he always said, and they say he flip-flops. This is how they deceive. And it's the public's fault for being gullible about this, not Donald Trump's. But again, this is a popular vine, they call it. It's less than 10 seconds. On the internet, that I think 5 million people have watched this on one channel alone on YouTube. And so in a way, all it does is make me really famous. I'm kind of like the meme king now. And then everybody comes and finds the real show and finds out that it's articulate, focused, interesting guests from Cy Hirst, the Pulitzer Prize winner, to Daniel Ellsberg, the Pentagon Papers, to Ron Paul, to Donald Trump, to Jesse Ventura, who's coming on in the next hour, to world leaders, the former head of the German CIA, Andres von Bülow, coming on and agreeing with me about 9/11. I mean, this is a serious broadcast. Journalists that are being censored, constitutional law professors. And then I have little entertaining stories, or I attempt to make them entertaining. Just like I played Caddyshack clips, where they fake open the bottle. And then I show her fake opening the jar of pickles. And then you know, I make a joke out of it, and they say I'm completely serious. I'm not discredited. They're discredited. The numbers show that. New media is incredibly trusted. Old media isn't trusted. And new media is trusted because of its true diversity. And that's why they're coming to try to censor it all. Here's an example of them editing clips. Trump charging into a goblin's nest, kissing goblins, goblin vomit, catching him in bed with a goblin. And it's pretty ridiculous, but I'm told you can't just watch it once. Let's watch it one more time. Trump charging into a goblin's nest, kissing goblins, goblin vomit, catch him in bed with a goblin. All right, so that sounds crazy. They edited it in a 10-minute allegory, I told. And I'm not claiming I'm the smartest guy around. Sometimes what I say I think is pretty darn interesting and informative. Sometimes it's a train wreck, but it's real. But then they had all these big esoteric publications and news sites go, this is incredibly sophisticated. He said he doesn't want Trump having political succubus, with Hillary and selling out to her under the table, but he doesn't think that's what's happening. And then I gave the whole goblin allegory, and then they turned it all into this big Kabbalistic analysis of what I was saying, but it wasn't Kabbalistic. All that archetypal ancient worldview systems are all basically the same. And so my gestalt of an archetype obviously would fit into a Kabbalistic rendering. But really what it is just spoken word that they then distort. But I'll put my spoken word up any day against all these little mental midgets that spend days crafting disinformation articles and editing videos together so they can sycophantically, pseudo-intellectually, foppishly, I use that word a lot because it's so good, pretend that they're actually proving themselves better than I. It's pretty easy to prove globalists wrong because they're always lying to the public. All they have is the confidence game that they put on. But I digress. Briefly, get the Hillary for President shirt for $9.95. That includes the shipping. Shirt costs us like $5. The shipping's about $5. It evens out in the wash. The problem is we're selling so many of these. I don't even know if my shipping department can handle it. So, and the shirt's going to sell out in the next few days. We're going to get a new design in. It'll be similar, but a different variant. But I have to say, it will not support the broadcast. It will just support the truth and exposing Hillary Clinton. If you want to support the broadcast, we have 20% off Vitamin Mineral Fusion drink mix, which is an amazing, again, bioavailable vitamin mineral supplement with cofactors, amino acids, and more. Fruit punch flavor, great for your children. This is a great way to actually absorb your multivitamin every day. Also, we have the new initial run of our BioTrue Selenium. Very, very absorbable. I cannot express to you enough how important selenium is and how most people from the research out there are deficient in it. It is key to electrochemical processes. In fact, I'm going to take one right now. I forgot to take one this weekend. I haven't taken a bottle of this home yet. This is the very best selenium you're going to find from the mighty mustard seed. The tiniest of seeds grows a huge plant, and it is powered basically by pure bioavailable selenium. And this, in one pill, is a nice dose. You take two a day. I mean, I get amazing energy from this. So, again, folks, check that out today at InfoWarsLife.com or by calling toll-free 888-253-3139. But Hillary for prison at cost. Also, the new Armageddon film, you can get a free bottle of colloidal silver. When you get a second film, great to spread the word on that front as well. I'm going to stop plugging at that point, kind of reset here and get back into the news. But I do want to also add the caveat that We have a lot of precious AM and FM affiliates out there. And if you're listening to us on an AM station, FM station, UHF, VHF TV, cable, whatever the case may be, we're in desperate times, and people are also ready to wake up right now. It's best of times, worst of times scenario. As things get bad, people are now ready to wake up. All the things we've talked about, that you've talked about, that others have, is happening. Put a sign up in your yard for the local station. Paint the side of your barn. If you got money, pay for a billboard. Call the station. Work with them on it. Become a sponsor. Support the local sponsors. Send them $20 in the mail. If you got it, $100. We're in a war. And a lot of times when things start getting bad, people pull back. They lose everything. That's why I have hired more people. That's why I've gotten more serious up here at the office. That's why I've been working 7 days a week. I'm now up here 7 days a week right now. Now, I do allow myself, you know, I only come up here 3-4 hours on Saturday and Sundays. But I'm working part-time now on the weekend because and I'm shooting more videos at night. Everybody sees it because now is the season to fight the tyranny. And it's now is the time to support the affiliates and folks that are also supporting us and themselves. So much is going on. And also pray for those local affiliates. And please pray for this broadcast because I shot a video, and this is our next piece of news. I shot a video up here with Rob Dew on Saturday, and it's a complex historical video. It took him until well into showtime the next day to even finish the video. It's 16 and a half minutes long, and it's posted on Infowars.com. Alex Jones asked Hillary not to kill him is the name of the article. The video posted on YouTube is titled, Hillary, Please Stop Killing People. And I show her laughing, talking about killing people. Madeleine Albright talking about 500,000 dead Iraqis is a good price to pay. Many of their horrible crimes, her threatening Obama. It goes on and on. Just to show you who's got the dark heart here. And let me explain something. I'm not a macho person. I don't go out and play chicken with people on the highway just to feel tough. I don't risk my name, my treasure, my sacred honor. If I don't think we can win, because I know we can win. If I didn't think we could win, I wouldn't do it. And I'm not just trying to mess with Hillary Clinton. She is a front person for a lot of more evil forces. And what she does is she kind of is famous for shooting the bat symbol up in the air like the commissioner does. But she shoots it up to have the different criminal mafias that feed from her go after whoever she calls out. And they're famous. They're one of the most vindictive families out there. And they think with their threats delivered through Jimmy Kimmel that, you know, we're going to get you Alex Jones and all the rest of it. They think that that scares me as if I don't already know that. No, them taking over fully and having their will with everyone, with George Soros, the Nazi collaborator, is of such a concern that I'm willing to go up against this monster. And I know you are as well. The mainstream media tries to make jokes about people that talk about the death list. But then Google, Twitter, Facebook, and everyone else admits they censor links to just the carnage, the death, the murder. I mean, I've interviewed the CIA head contractor from MENA, Terry Reid, probably 10, 15 times. By the way, he used to basically work at WorldNet Daily. We need to call Joseph Farah and ask if he has Terry Reid's contact. It's my number for him. He hadn't been on like 10 years. I haven't had Terry Reid on like 10 years. There's a bounty out, folks. Whoever gets me Terry Reid's number, $500. He wrote Clinton, Bush, and the CIA. It's all completely fake. These people have run wars, killing millions of innocent people. And then their political enemies get killed. You have all these DNC staffers getting killed, shot in the back, executed. Lawyers that sue over Bernie Sanders get executed. And then, oh, look at Alex Jones. He's worried about Hillary killing him. No, I'm saying I'm doing this no matter what. And I want it to be known that if something happens to me, that the prime suspect is the criminal combines in and around the Clinton crime family. I'm a reporter going up against the real La Cosa Nostra. I'm a reporter and a news agency that this war criminal has singled out directly. And people she does that to end up having big problems. And I'm saying I'm not a loser if they come and destroy me. The point is just understand that we did this for the right reason. And I'm shining spotlight on it so that hopefully they're not too arrogant and think they can get away with it. But we're entering the climate where they openly want to censor the press and create fear. They might come after somebody like myself now just because I am so prominent and they're taken to the next level. This is a very serious criminal organization we're talking about. By the way, we have the clip of her with the doctor with the EpiPen saying, it's all right. It's okay. Everything's going to be all right. I'm going to play that in the next segment, where she looks completely mentally ill. Meanwhile, they're saying all over the news that Donald Trump's mentally ill. Oh, yeah, he works 18 hours a day. He's a super alpha male, no criminal record, doesn't take drugs. They said his doctor recanted. I saw the headline on CNN. I went and looked at it. His doctor said, listen, I just wrote that real quick. I've done exams on him, but I wrote that real quick and was just, point is, he doesn't drink. He doesn't use drugs. He's as healthy as anybody his age that exercises. He's really healthy. They turned that into him recanting, saying Donald Trump's as healthy as anybody that's ever been president. Most people are pretty darn sick once they get in the presidency. That's why the doctor, who's prestigious, said that. Donald Trump is a horse. He drinks a gallon of milk a day. He eats 3 or 4 steaks a day, about 10 eggs a day, big dishes of vegetables. Donald Trump is a throwback. I mean, Donald Trump's drug is food. That's it. And he likes women, too. I mean, my God, what's wrong with that? So he's a red-blooded American. They can't stand it, and they're saying he's mentally ill. But here's Trump, as we go out to break, talking about he thinks that they have her emails at the NSA. Well, that comes from William Binney, the former head of the NSA, here on this broadcast just a month ago. Here it is.
When she deleted 33,000 emails, those emails had some really bad stuff on them, because look at the ones that they found, and these are probably a lot worse. And then not only did they delete them, they used a method of deletion that you can never get them back. You saw that yesterday. Yes. For the first time. So she knew what she was deleting. It's a criminal act. She knew exactly what she was deleting.
And using that kind of extensive, bleaching technique, et cetera, shows a consciousness of guilt, we would argue,
well,
as
expensive.
A prosecutor. Yeah.
It's very expensive. Probably, I don't know, foolproof. I don't know. I hear the NSA maybe has the emails. A lot of people say NSA would have the emails if they really wanted to get them. But obviously, they don't want to get them. They're protecting her. They're coddling her. And it's the only way she can even consider running. I mean, she shouldn't be allowed to run. But to use that method of getting rid of, permanently rid of emails that most people never even heard of.
Let's stop right there.
People.
By the way, it's come out they were selling favors with the communist Chinese president. She should be arrested right now. That's in the news today. I mean, this is a crime syndicate. Who's going to stand up to them? I mean, what's the limit? How far will they go? So Donald Trump comes out and says, I hear that the NSA has Hillary Clinton's emails. Yes. The former technical leader of the NSA, the guy that invented much of what's being used today, William Binney's been a frequent guest on the broadcast. And earlier this month, we're going to play that clip in a moment, he came on and said that we have her emails, but so do foreign governments. She was the Secretary of State, and it's in the news today. We're going to be covering this coming up, that she indeed was selling access to the Chinese president as Secretary of State. She got billions and billions of dollars. Talk about espionage. This is incredible. These emails should absolutely destroy her. But she's blackmailing the rest of the government, threatening to bring the whole thing down, and she's scared to death that DrudgeReport.com and Infowars.com and a few others, like WikiLeaks, are willing to cover this information. And now they're panicking because even the Jerusalem Post came out and said, it's damning. George Soros is global chaos leader and is trying to overthrow the planet. He is a megalomaniac. These are quotes. We have them. We have Soros saying, censor the internet now. Shut down their competition in these emails. And the UN gets control October 1st, unless Congress takes action and says no. That's in the Wall Street Journal. That's how real this is. We've been warning about it, trying to stop it. They've got it all lined up now, and we're here in the final phase, where more happens in a year than happened in the previous 10. And with high technology today, that's only compounded. So Donald Trump is right. Let's play William Binney on with us early this month.
You know, it's not really that they've hacked into the server or the DNC server or Hillary server. It's they've got over, in the United States, in the Fairview program, they have over 100 taps on the fiber network in the United States. And they're doing just like Mark Klein exposed the one facility, one of the 100, in the San Francisco facility, where they have Naris devices taking everything off the line. So that's what's going on.
They're so to explain, they put gates in front of it and then copy it and scoop it all up before it ever gets where it's going.
That's right. That's exactly right. As it passes down the line from all the service providers or all the telephone companies, they capture that as it's passing down the fiber network. And the telecommunications companies are helping them do that. The ones that run the fibers, they allow them to come in and tap the thing. That's what Mark Klein exposed in the AT&T facility in San Francisco. But that's only one of the almost 100 that they have. And it captures tens of gigabits of data. So at each site. So that means that's how they acquire the data. And then they're storing it in places like the Bluffdale facility that they had to build because they were collecting so much. And now they're building another facility on Fort Meade that's almost three times that size. It's 2.8 million square feet. So that's planning for the future because they're continuing to collect so much data on everybody.
Now, something else Donald Trump is right about. The KKK. Robert Byrd was a Ku Klux Klan leader. A senior leader. He is a mentor of Hillary Clinton. Hillary Clinton and her husband basically got elected co-governor at a time in Arkansas when the Klan still completely ran the state. Let me give you a newsflash. There isn't a state more Klan. Not even Alabama. No, it's Arkansas, baby. And let me tell you, kissing Robert Byrd, praising him, saying that he was her mentor, speaking at his funeral, Bill saying he had to join the Klan to get elected to office. Well, whatever. There isn't any connection to Donald Trump and the KKK. The guy from New York City. I mean, give me a break. Who opens golf courses up to black people first 40 years ago when nobody wanted those elite golf courses and hires more African-Americans statistically than any of those big casino owners. And then he sits there and you call him the KKK. But now Media Matters comes out and says Trump adopts right-wing media's flawed Robert Byrd canard to distract from allegations of racism. All right. Well, we've seen a lot of journalists like Larry King who would actually hear both sides of an issue or five or six different sides of it run off of CNN and then the ratings dropped roughly eight times what they were with him by the time Piers Morgan left. That's official. From 6, 7, 8 million viewers, which they thought was bad, down to 500,000 viewers. And he's now on RT and has a popular weekly magazine program seen by hundreds of millions around the world. It shows the decline of Western media. Things like RT is in more homes and seen by more people now than CNN, Fox News, MSNBC, CNBC combined. Look it up. We can make big announcements today. Jesse Ventura just signed with Russia Today. Just to illustrate what's happened to our media that isn't American media, but is globalist media. And he's got other big breaking news on the Eighth Circuit, reversing his case, refusing to hear it, with no comment. You're going to hear stuff that is unprecedented, exclusively here today, from Jesse Ventura, former Minnesota governor. And it goes further than that. Huffington Post bans journalists for writing about Hillary's health, deletes article. DC leaks website down. Twitter suspends account after releasing Soros docs that calls for the UN to take over the internet. That's the Wall Street Journal today. An internet giveaway to the UN. And George Soros saying the NGO UN will censor and regulate the internet to, quote, favor open society supporters and not those that go along with them. Jesse Ventura had him come in and try to shut down his TV show. I've experienced it myself. Ladies and gentlemen, it's happening. And it's getting more and more and more and more naked. And again, you're saying, okay, Jesse Ventura's court case with Chris Kyle. I'm not asking people out there to take even sides on that case. I've talked to people that knew Kyle, people close to Kyle. The way he was killed, the word is he was executed to cover up whatever was really going on. Just like what we saw with Pat Tillman having to be taken out. He wasn't going along. Just like we saw Private Lynch, five of her cohorts that said the story wasn't true all got killed. She came out and said it's all fake. Jesse Ventura took it to a jury. He won. And he's going to break down today the incredible information because he was going after the insurers, not Chris Kyle's wife. And that's why they overturned it, because they don't want the public to know that Jesse Ventura wasn't going after a widow. None of it was even true. It's incredible, ladies and gentlemen. Spent more money than he was asking for just to prove it was a lie. This is the age of psyops, folks, where they'll say anything. They'll say Donald Trump's in the KKK. None of it's true. They'll say I love the KKK, but I'm famous for protesting it. This is a time when they'll assassinate your character, and we all have to stand together, or we're going to hang separate. He's the expert on it. He's now able to tell you everything. I talked to him last week. It was unbelievable. This affects jurisprudence. It affects all of us getting a fair trial. It affects the 50-something megacorporations that signed on and countersued Ventura. From News Corp to Time Warner to the New York Times. Because they want to have a precedent set to be able to lie and have enrichment from it. So all you can get is a couple hundred thousand dollars when they make $50 million off lying about you and destroy you. Well, Jesse Ventura isn't destroyed, but he's fighting for his good name. And he's a friend of mine. That's why we got him here today. Governor, thank you for coming on with us. You've got the floor. I've never heard you so focused and quietly angry. Launch into what you told me last week when you said you wanted to give us the exclusive.
Well, Alex, you know, you're hitting the nail on the head. You know, my case got so big. I'll run down a quick list of all the media people that entered it. And as you said, they wanted the unjust enrichment overturned, which the Eighth Circuit Court of Appeals accommodated them, even though they argued a different theory in front of the Eighth Circuit than what was argued in the actual trial, which is illegal. Well, not illegal, but they're not supposed to be allowed to do that. And amazingly, 3 days after they ruled my way against me and allowed this theory to come in after the trial, there was another case where they tried to bring in the 11th Amendment after the trial and they denied it. So they go whichever way is politically they want to do it. They're not going by their rules. They're not going by the law. Now, some of the media that entered this case, A&E Television Networks, the Association of American Publishers, the Authors Guild, BuzzFeed, Inc., Cox Media Group, Scripps Company, Forbes Media, Gannett Company, Gawker, Hatchet, the list goes down the line of all. And these are names you may not be used to because they're corporate names. These are the corporations that run all the media. The National Association of Broadcasters, National Press Photographers, New York Media, New York Times Company, Penguin, Random House, Time Incorporated, Tribune Publishing. The list goes on and on. And the reason they wanted this overturned is precisely what you said, Alex, so that they can go out and defame people. They don't have to do any background checking. They don't have to even know if it's true or not. They can defame you to make money. And then when they're done making the money, you, the defamed person, can't get any of that money from them. And the court stood up and said that that's fine. Now, that isn't even the biggest one. The biggest thing they did was they turned the case over and ordered a new trial based upon that the truth came out. And let me explain. During the trial, Taya Kyle got on the stand and did what's called poor mouthing. She told the jury that this trial was running her out of money, that it was a huge financial burden on her and her children, which was not true. We knew it. They knew it. She knew it.
Give folks the numbers. Give folks the numbers.
Well, insurance was paying for it all on their side. On my side, I've forked out almost just a little over $1 million now to defend myself. Their side paid by insurance. Now, what happened was the judge still wouldn't allow us to tell the jury the truth that insurance was paying for it until late in the trial. Late in the trial, they brought in two witnesses from HarperCollins, the book company, who were downplaying my importance on purpose because they knew they were going to lose and they wanted to lower the award and make it as low as possible. Well, at that point, federal Judge Kyle, who presided over the case, ruled that was too much. It was a conflict of interest, these book company people coming in. So he allowed the insurance to come into the trial limited. Now, here's what it was. It was four questions of these HarperCollins two people out of an 11-day trial, and it was a half a page of a 20-page final lawyer summary. Now, the rules, it was never objected to by the other side when it was allowed in. The rules state clearly, even from the Supreme Court, that if during final arguments it must be objected to in front of the jury to give the presiding judge an opportunity to rule in front of the jury.
And they didn't.
They did not.
And let's be clear, you've got one of the top lawyers in the country. You've won other suits other people have failed.
Really, that's irrelevant. It's the rules themselves.
No, I'm saying this is cut and dry, and even I know that from law. It's cut and dry.
So at 11:58, they dismissed the jury. At 12:02, they objected to the insurance being brought into the trial. The judge overruled them immediately, and it was over. Well, these two judges, Shepard and Riley, took it upon themselves that they felt it should have been objected to, so they did it after on their own.
But that would deceive the jury. And I mean, let's talk about the hundreds of millions of dollars that have been made. Last time I heard, she's raked in 40-something million, but I want to be clear. I want to separate even Chris Kyle out of this, because I know people that actually served with him as SEALs, but also Army, that was involved, and they believe there was a setup. He was executed up by Dallas and a cover-up, and that PSYOP somehow was inserted into the book, that he was somehow instructed. SEALs are never involved, as you know, formerly one, in propaganda. The Army says they'll never be involved. This was unprecedented that this happened, and something's going on here. There's a cover-up going on, and at very high levels, they don't want you to be able to prove that wasn't true. But you've done that to a jury, and I just want to point out, I like Daily Caller, but I'm going to correct them. They have a new article out. Jesse Ventura wants the Supreme Court to make Chris Kyle's widow pay him millions. Anybody that studied the case knows the lie is that Jesse Ventura is beating up a widow. Jesse Ventura said, you know, take that back, and then I'm not going to sue you. Well, he got killed before he could take it back, basically, and I guess he wouldn't take it back before that.
That is not true. Let's be truthful here, Alan.
Well, you didn't hear the end. I said he got.
Wait,
I guess he
minute.
Did take it back, or didn't?
I gave Chris Kyle. I left for Mexico, and I drive there, and I live off the grid, so I had no way to respond. This story broke in January, 2 weeks after I got down to Mexico. I was unable to come back because I drive. I don't fly, and so we brought lawsuit immediately in June. Chris Kyle kept saying we could work it out if we met. In June, we had our first settlement conference, June of 2012. I met face-to-face with Chris Kyle. I looked him right in the eye. I said, how can you do this when you know it didn't happen? I said, if you will go out today and admit it was fabricated, I will forgive you, and we will both go about our business. Chris Kyle did not have the courage to tell the truth.
Sure, Governor, let me stop you just to be clear here. Obviously, I'm the guy that called and told you. You got the word from me. I know the story. You are correct. What I was saying is, and I didn't get to finish it, so what I did say was incorrect because I hadn't finished it. I'm saying he didn't ever get a chance by the end to basically go back on what he said. And
he
for
wouldn't have anyway.
I think he was getting ready to.
At all. It's a C story. It's a common thing in the Navy. It's called a C story. You lie to your buddies and you tell them a big story and your buddies all believe it, and then the lie becomes the truth. And that's exactly
sure.
What Chris Kyle
did. Well, he
did
die very suspiciously, and I'm just trying to depoliticize it because they try to do it. You never went after his widow. She never lost money. She makes tens of millions of dollars. You were just getting your name back.
Yes, and it was, and Taya Kyle or the children haven't lost a penny. An insurance company paid for it all. But the other side wanted to make me look bad. So they perpetrated this myth that I was going after the widow and the children. And that's what they've tried to do through this whole thing. And it's as dishonest as you can imagine. And that's what I'm up against. And now the Circuit Court of Appeals overturns it and orders a new trial, and based on something that was never objected to in the actual trial.
Well, so, I mean, look.
Wait, Alex, that's a 76-year rule that has been intact.
I understand.
Mine is the first case they have gone against that rule.
Which shows more and more government and the courts are doing whatever they want. It's lawless. I totally agree. The fact that she can come in and say, Jesse Ventura is trying to make me poor, and you can't point out and impeach that that is incorrect, and that she's making tens of millions, and that it's her insurance company that's just going to have to give you a few million, that is wild that they're saying that can't be given to the jury, even though they're the ones that didn't object.
Exactly. And that's what went down here. You had two activist judges, Riley and Shepard. It was a 2-1, who both allowed this to happen, even though they violated their own rules.
Why do you think they did this? Why do you think they went so far?
Well, they don't like me, obviously. And but what it tells me, and let me add this, these are not only dishonest judges because they're not even following their own rule. And let me put this into context. It's like golf. You go out and play golf. It's a game of honesty. Not everybody can watch you every minute. You're dependent upon being honest to the rules. If you don't, you're a dishonest golfer. Same thing for these judges. They have rules. They have court rules.
Speaking of judges, are you saying they're Judge Schmales? These guys are Judge Schmales.
They're worse because they cause way more damage. They don't follow their own rules. That makes them dishonest. And let me add this. They wrote a 29-page summary of this case. Never once during those 29 pages did they give me my title as governor. I was referred to completely as Ventura. Now, an example. I flew over to Moscow last December. I met President Vladimir Putin. He called me governor. So the head of Russia gives me more respect than two federal judges on the Eighth Circuit Court of Appeals.
Well, you always say governor in somebody's title after they've been governor.
Tax dollars.
You always say governor, especially in written documents when someone's been a governor.
They didn't. There isn't one reference to me as governor in the entire 29 pages they wrote.
Look, the big corporations that donate money want to set the precedent to be able to lie about whoever they want. I mean, they go on MSNBC and say, quote, I am deeply racist. Alex Jones hates black people. Alex Jones wants to hurt Hillary Clinton. All this bull. They just more and more, the lies are just crazy.
Well, and they can get away with it because, Alex, the judges back them up. The judges allow, with this ruling in my case, you got nothing to get them on. The media will be able to lie about anybody, and you will not be able to get any unjust enrichment thanks to these two judges who took it upon themselves.
Sure.
And to overrule a jury. Now, how disrespectful is that of the jury of Minnesota who heard? Now, and think of this, for all you naysayers out there who think that I'm wrong, how much evidence must there have been for a jury to overrule the war veteran passed away, the deceased war veteran, and his weeping, crying wife who cried in the courtroom? And yet, the evidence was so overwhelming, they found in my favor because the jury did their job. I commend the jury.
They absolutely. Well, I've seen the evidence. I've seen the evidence.
They looked at the evidence. Yet you have two judges here that never sat in for 1 second of the trial and basically told the jury they were wrong.
Well, Governor, let's go further here. Let's just go back to the case. You are somebody, and I've flown around the country with, you know, taping the TV shows, shooting them. And I've seen you, the only time you get emotional is when you see troops getting on planes and, you know, you talk to them and say, you know, be safe. You know, these wars and things are, you know, based on lies. And you go to commencements, you go to memorials, you speak at them. You were there to be part of the commencement, and you're going to stand there in the most popular Navy SEAL bar and say, I'm glad Navy SEALs are getting killed. Clearly, that's designed to defame you. It's bigger than saying he beat you up. And so what I'm saying is, talking to the family of Pat Tillman, talking and warning, you know, Private Lynch, who then went obviously public and said it's all fake, that when you're involved in propaganda at that level, and when you start to go south, they tend to get rid of you. Or if you're about to speak out, look at Pat Tillman, who they executed. I mean, even the Army coroner, who was a colonel, said he was executed. He was assassinated. He was murdered. That's what happened. And so I'm simply saying, there's a way to basically go around their propaganda that you're suing his wife, which you're not. You're suing the people that, you know, put this whole lie out to get the insurance and to have the jury, you know, come out and say, yes, you proved your case, which you did. I'm saying, if you give us your view on political assassinations and how mysterious this is that he died, it kind of just goes around the whole propaganda nest they've set up. I mean, let me put it to you this way, Governor. What do you think really happened here? I mean, this is pretty suspicious what happened to Chris Kyle.
Well, it's suspicious in the fact all of it is. You know, I tried to stay away from his tragic death, but I, for one, am trying to figure out, okay, Kyle and his friend are with this Marine who's suffering from post-traumatic stress. First of all, how is Chris Kyle or his friend at all trained to deal with post-traumatic stress? They're not. So why is it their obligation to do what they allegedly were doing? Second of all, common sense. Someone suffering from post-traumatic stress, I would look at that and go, the last thing I would do is put a loaded weapon in his hands. And that's what they did out at this firing range, apparently. I don't want to comment on the death because I wasn't there. I don't know what happened. But all I know is this Marine with heavy post-traumatic stress got a loaded weapon put in his hand and subsequently killed two people. And I'm trying to figure out where Kyle and his friend got the medical expertise to be treating post-traumatic
stress. Well, let me tell you what I've been told.
Which is what they said they were doing.
Well, I'm here in Texas, so let me just tell you what I've been told about people that are on record friends with Kyle. None of them buy it. They say that's not really what happened. And so you've got this book, nothing against Clint Eastwood, I love him, that's going to be this big $500 million movie and all the rest of it. And I'm telling you, there are people upstairs that didn't want that narrative getting disrupted, and Chris Kyle magically then disappears. And take the Boston bombing. I'm not saying Kraft International was involved. We know there were drills that day. We know there were guys wearing the Kraft uniform with the Punisher hats that were there with black backpacks, probably part of the same drill. I'm telling you, Kyle was involved in some really heavy stuff. And the people I know him say that they don't buy the official story, Jesse.
Well, that I'm not going to get into because I don't know that much about it, and nor do I even want to particularly.
Sure, I understand.
I have to deal with my end of it, and my end of it is that Kyle was killed, and that's standard procedure. Then my lawsuit was against him because he defamed me. When he dies, it automatically switches to his estate. And the estate is covered by insurance, and anybody that writes a book, here's the bottom line. I've written 7 or 8 New York.
You got to pay insurance money. You got to pay for the insurance.
Everyone that writes a book is covered by insurance. Your book publisher has insurance against defamation.
It's O&E. It is part of a book deal that part of the money you don't get is what goes to the insurance.
And yet they wanted the court, or the other side wanted to deceive the jury into thinking that Jesse Ventura was taking money from this widow and children, and the other side perpetrated that myth the
sure.
whole trial.
Well, Governor, here's the good news.
Judges standing up for it.
I'm no lawyer, but I've studied the law. They're not going to be able to keep this out next time either. There's an absolute right if she gets up there and says you're taking all her money and taking her kids' money. You're going to be able to point out it's insurance again. That's just not true.
No, we can't because they'll overturn it again.
I don't see how you're allowed to tell a jury that the money's coming from you and tell the press that, and then you can't point out there's insurance for News Corp.
I can tell you why. Because the insurance lobby has lobbied the politicians through dirty bribe money, and they've gotten the judicial department. The belief is that if a jury knows insurance is paying for it, insurance companies have screwed everybody over, so they're going to stick it to the insurance company. But the reality is the insurance company pays off the politicians who appoint the judges, and then that's why it's not allowed. The truth is not allowed in the court.
And by the way, you were basically...
Alex, I'll give you another example.
Got to go to break, sir. Stay right there.
All right.
A former talk show host, he knows about those. Jesse Ventura is our guest. This case is big, folks. It goes into a lot of areas. Stay with us. Governor Ventura during the break was pointing out that the court's supposed to be a place where the truth comes in. He was saying in more and more cases, it's a place for lies. But his judge was good. His jury saw the facts. And it didn't matter. Because now the Eighth Circuit just said, without comment, no. So now Governor Ventura is going to have a whole other trial after spending over $1 million of his own money. And you look at the amount he was asking for, it wasn't even that much. He's basically spent what he's trying to get just to get a ruling to say that's not true. And see, if they can do it to him, they can do it to anybody. I think that's why Trump is right when he says that the libel and slander laws are not strong enough in this country. I only attack big establishment people that I can really defend that George Soros is trying to overthrow this country. We've got his emails that prove it. I don't just sit there and just randomly say, I beat up Jesse Ventura, and he said he's glad the Navy SEALs are dying. I mean, I'm a big man. Well, then I'm going to have to face that in court. And again, I don't want to sit here and even choose sides in all this. It's a tragedy. He won in court, and now look what's happened. And again, don't let them trick you into making this about a widow. We're going to go back to Governor Ventura here in just a minute. That's the big secret they don't want out, is that it was insurance, News Corp, Fox, billions and billions and billions a year. News Corp is 30, 40, 50 billion a year. It's not just Fox News. They put this book out. They promoted it. They didn't tell their viewers that. I can just hear the folks involved, you know, saying, why don't you add this in there? Because they were involved in dirty tricks against Ventura then because they've been scared of him. So we're going to be breaking all that down coming up. We have a really, really big special running right now. It's 20% off on the Vitamin Mineral Fusion drink. It is concentrated. It's great for your family. It's great for your children. It has massive absorbability of the organic vitamins and minerals and trace elements and amino acids. This is light years better than the pill form of even somewhat bioavailable organic multivitamins. The way to drink it is obviously as a fruit punch, and your purchase supports the broadcast. And look at this. You know, I drink this every day at home, but I tend to forget to do it at work. But then I thought, why not just get a pitcher of this? The crew loves it anyways, and have some on air. And the great part about it is it's healthy, it's natural, to the highest quality, it's affordable, and it funds this broadcast. So get your Vitamin Mineral Fusion exclusively at InfoWarsLife.com today, or call toll-free 888-253-3139. And we also have our first run of bioavailable selenium, new to the family at InfoWarsLife.com. Purely organic, very strong, from the mustard seed, used throughout your body in electrochemical activity inside the cells, inside the neurons. You can go read about it on the site. You can go look at studies for yourself about selenium, and it's just as important as vitamin C or True Nation iodine like X2. It goes together with those. That's InfoWarsLife.com or call toll-free 888-253-3139. And finally, since Hillary Clinton came out last week and said, I have this dark, evil heart, and I'm a horrible person because I say 9/11 was an inside job and Oklahoma City was an inside job, and then they misrepresent what I say about Sandy Hook. Other people are sure it's all actors. They're mad at me that I'm not saying they're all actors. I'm saying Anderson Cooper's on a blue screen up there, so the adults are acting like actors. Bloomberg sent an email out the day before saying, get ready, something big's about to happen. Get ready to go after the guns, to his little anti-gun group. It's a big anti-gun group. And so she misrepresents. So we're having Operation Dark Heart special, Hillary for Prison shirts at cost, $9.95. That includes shipping. InfoWarsStore.com is the big umbrella site. InfoWarsStore.com or call toll-free 888-253-3139. It's sending a huge message out there across the world. Hillary Clinton, all her wars, all her warmongering. You know, people could say, well, I don't like Trump or Hillary. Trump didn't launch all the different wars, all the different bombings, Libya, Syria. Hillary bragged she came, she saw Gaddafi died. Hillary is clearly far worse. And I know, Governor Ventura, I want to go to you on this just briefly, and then back into the court case, which affects us all. I know you're always a third-party guy, and I've supported third parties because usually we have a McCain and an Obama, or we have, you know, a George Bush and a, you know, somebody else who's just as bad. But I got to tell you, clearly with these emails, clearly with Hillary and all these wars, clearly with her whole history and how long she's been in and vacationing with the Bushes and all of it, your knowledge of that is lengthy. You've written big books on these families. I would just really love to see you come out and support Donald Trump. I know you played golf with him, been, you know, known him for decades. And I guess you've been friends with him. I mean, I would really love to see you at least, you know, come out and say, well, Donald Trump's better than Hillary. What's your view on that?
Well, unfortunately, I'm not going to do that because I'm supporting Gary Johnson, the libertarian candidate for president, who's better than both of them. I vote for the person that I want to be president. I don't vote against someone. I vote for someone. And I'm voting for Governor Johnson and Governor Weld. I think that they're the best thing that could happen because they'll get us, number one, I vehemently oppose the wars in the Middle East. They are the only candidates that's them and Dr. Stein that'll get us out of the Middle East. And I oppose the war on drugs. And Gary Johnson's the only candidate that will stand up and attempt to end.
Sure. What about how he's for the TPP? Donald's against the TPP.
Well, that's wonderful. But Donald's also, I'm not for turning the United States into East Berlin, and Donald is. You know, I have bigger differences with Donald than I do with Gary Johnson. Therefore, I vote for someone. I will be voting for Gary Johnson, and I already endorsed Gary Johnson.
Well, I'll say this. I agree with a lot of what Gary Johnson has to say, but clearly the Koch brothers and the big money are now getting in there more and more, taking over the Libertarian Party because they don't want Trump in. I mean, I've never seen the power structure more scared of a candidate. But I mean, obviously, if there wasn't third parties there, and I get your commitment and your integrity to build third parties for, you know, decades outside of the two-party system. So I think that's a legitimate point of view from your perspective. But clearly, the power structure worldwide, the communist Chinese president, the Pope, the Saudi Arabians, I mean, every criminal group crawling out from under rocks against Donald Trump, the power structure of the New World Order is really scared of him.
Well, they might be. I don't know. But like I said, I don't vote against people. I vote for people. And to me, Gary Johnson is by far and away the best man that I want to be president. Donald Trump will continue the wars. Donald Trump, in fact, all the Republicans, in my opinion, should have been disqualified. You know why?
Why?
Because they all said they would torture. Every of the 16 Republican candidates all admitted they would commit a war crime. I'm a veteran. I take offense when a potential commander-in-chief admits before they even become the commander-in-chief that they will go out and commit war crimes.
Well, I mean, that's one of my issues with Trump. His point is he's informed, torture is still going on, and he's just being honest about it.
Well, and that may be, but you don't join in, and because it's happening doesn't make it right.
No, I hear you.
We as the United States should be above that, for God's sake.
I agree with you, and then we get tortured, we lose the high ground. He's being honest, and I see his point, I don't agree with it, that these are ISIS. If you're admitted ISIS, and you know, you're raping little girls and killing people, we're going to torture you to find out where your cohorts are. I mean, you know, that's kind of the line of thinking, and I think it's a bad line of thinking.
That line of thinking is wrong.
I hear you.
That is wrong, because they've already proved torture doesn't get you.
Okay, I got it. Now, you said you like Johnson because you're closer to him than Trump. What about Hillary? Do you agree with me that Hillary, though, is worse than Trump?
I think both of these political parties and their candidates are as bad as each other. You're not going to get any advantage one over the other. Donald Trump is now a Republican. Therefore, you have to embrace the Republican Party.
But the whole Republican Party came out against him.
Wait a minute, Alex. Look who he picked to run with him.
That's a good point.
The most solid Republican you could possibly pick of the in crowd, Pence.
I don't know if he's like a rhino. That'd be Paul Ryan, I think, would be the biggest in crowd guy.
Well, Pence is right there with him. He's just a governor. That's the difference. Ryan's on the national scale. Pence is at the state level. Pence is as far right as you can get. He's another one of these guys that wants to, he's opposed.
Well, let me ask you this then. Why is the establishment?
All these social issues. He's a typical Republican that wants to be in your bedroom.
But then Trump comes out and you know, says we need to, you know, have equal rights for gays and lesbians in his main speech. So that's Trump.
Well, again, like I said, he still embraced the Republican.
But even the Washington Post said, even Washington Post said Hillary
Sanders is not an independent. Bernie Sanders is a Democrat.
Yeah, Bernie Sanders. What'd you think of him when they stole the nomination from him? Even Stanford Research Institute says, no, it was stolen from him. And then he didn't even make a big deal out of it.
Well, it's sad I knew he wouldn't, because I spoke to Bernie over a year ago. And I asked him point blank. He gave me about a minute and cold shouldered me up in Minnesota. I asked him, if you fail to unseat Hillary, will you continue the movement as a third party or support a third party? He said, no, I will endorse Hillary. Well, right there I knew. He's not an independent. He's a Democrat. He's masking as an independent.
He's very arrogant.
You know, he's a Democrat. The same way as Donald joining the Republicans. He's now a Republican. I wouldn't vote for a Republican or Democrat. I'd sooner not vote.
No, I know. You're all about long-term. You're all about long-term breaking their monopoly. And I hear you. We should have the other candidates in the debates. We really should have Gary Johnson.
Especially this year. This year, you got two candidates where their negatives are through the roof. Nobody likes either one of them. This is the year. If given a third choice up on that podium during the debates, you would see a ton of people switch to Gary Johnson. You'll see the Democrats and Republicans in bed together. They'll be in bed together stopping Johnson and Stein from getting in the debates. There they'll be singing Kumbaya by the fire together. They will.
No, I hear you.
Mark my words. You'll see the Dems and Repubs totally team up to keep Johnson and Stein out of debates. All four of those candidates should, and I'm an example, Alex, because I was polling less than Gary Johnson's polling right now. I was polling 10% at Labor Day. I was allowed in the debates in Minnesota, and in 60 days, I was the governor of Minnesota.
You've got a point. You've got a point. If Gary Johnson had more personality like you, and he got in the debates, I think he'd probably be the winner because he has a lot less negatives, and Frank Quigley has a broader appeal overall with his message. That's a really good point.
Yeah, but the point is the Dems and Repubs ain't going to allow him in because they know that, too. They know what I did in Minnesota, and they're not going to repeat the same thing. Look what they did with the presidential debates. Up until 92, they were run by the National League of Women Voters, basically a nonpartisan group. After Perot scared them, they formed the Federal Debate Commission, which is headed by the Dems and Repubs' former head, and they took over the debates. So you got the Democrats and Republicans deciding who gets to debate.
No, that's why I brought it up. I mean,
that's the proverbial fox in the hen house.
Yes, but I agree with you. But look at how the Republican Party pulled out all the stops and tried to steal the nomination from Trump. He fought back. They failed. I see it more as an insurrection, a populist movement taking over the Republicans, at least until he brought Pence in. That was just to stop the Republicans from trying to totally overthrow him. But I get your point. He does a lot of great things and then does some bad things. But look at how the big money is giving him no money. We've never seen this in 50, 60 years, the Republican nominee getting no money from big interest. That is a big plus for Donald Trump. I mean, come on, Governor Ventura, give it to him.
Well, certainly that's a plus for him. But I noticed that he's still going to big popular Republican fundraisers, though, isn't he?
Well, he's going like to the $5,000 plate.
Wait, I don't buy for an instant he's not getting supported by Republican money.
He's not getting the Koch brothers. He's not getting the big super PACs.
Why would he be going to
no big pharma
if he wasn't getting money?
I mean, he's flying into places like Austin and Dallas and stuff, and it's $1,000, $2,000, $3,000 a plate. That's not establishment, people. That's pretty grassroots. He's not getting any big pharma, any big Wall Street.
Some of this stuff isn't grassroots either.
A lot of it is. The point is that the power structure is giving most of his money to Hillary. But
Alex, you and I will beg to differ. You can vote for Trump. I'll vote for Gary Johnson.
I'll say this, 800-259-9231, 800-259-9231. Quick questions for former Minnesota Governor Jesse Ventura. Hey, listen, now, if you were running for president, that'd be a different thing. But you didn't do it, did you?
No, I did not. I couldn't go all in on it. I was up for the run. I was up to fight to get in the debates, but I wasn't up for doing the job for 4 years. And in those jobs, you got to be 100%.
Which makes you presidential material that you don't want the power. I mean, who wants that? Doesn't Hillary look ill to you?
For age reasons. I'm 65 now, and I didn't want to have to clean up the Democrats and Republican mess for 4 years. I didn't make the mess. They did it.
No, you get blamed for it. That's one thing. If Trump gets in, he's going to get blamed for it all. That's a good point.
Sure, just like Obama got blamed for all the crap George Bush did.
Now, I'm no fan of Bush, but let's be honest. Bush was like half of what happened. The Clintons getting rid of Glass-Steagall. You did films on that, allowing all those huge debts. I mean, they're really to blame more than Bush for the economy.
Well, granted, and in fact, I'll state this. Hillary Clinton's most important vote as a senator was when she voted to go into the Iraq war.
That's right.
And now she's backpedaling, saying it was her worst vote. Well, that alone disqualifies her for me, because as commander-in-chief, her biggest thing was to go to war when it was wrong. And she did it as a senator.
Hey, don't you feel vindicated?
Finger on the button? No, thank you.
You did a whole 9/11 show on the Saudi role alone and the stand down and got criticized. Now it's all confirmed. So we're vindicated.
Yeah. Isn't that something? It's all confirmed now, but yet Jesse Ventura is still a crazy man. Jesse Ventura still goes after widows and children, you know, and yet everything I talk about comes out to be true 10 years later.
800-259-9231.
Alex, I should be one of those people and make money where people come in and you look in the ball, the crystal ball.
Fortune teller. Let's talk to Bob in Connecticut. Bob, you're on the air with Governor Jesse Ventura. Go ahead.
Go ahead,
Bob.
Jesse, the thing is this. you know, you want to support Gary Johnson. He picked as his vice presidential candidate.
Hey, calm down. I can barely understand you, okay? Just don't yell, okay? Calm down, caller. Right. Go ahead.
I'm sorry. Jesse, the Gary Johnson's vice presidential candidate, he's a gun grabber. This whole thing is, obviously, you don't realize the precarious situation our country is in right now. This is going to be our last election. If Donald Trump does not win this election, America is done.
All right, let me get Ventura's take on that, Jesse.
Well, first of all, I'm not buying into that because Donald Trump's a Republican, and you elect another Republican, so what? And Hillary's a Democrat.
Well, let me say this:
I don't support either Democrats or Republicans, and it's my right to do that
as a
citizen in America.
Well, listen, a big plus for you is you're totally pro Second Amendment. And I have seen some evidence that Johnson's VP guy is not pro-gun.
Well, maybe he is, maybe he isn't. But remember, that's a VP. It's the president that matters, not the VP.
And Johnson is pro-gun.
I assume so. He's from New Mexico.
No, I mean, I wouldn't call him a super hardcore guy like me. But he's pretty good. And I mean, I'd call you a...
Look at it this way.
Hold on, Jesse. We got to go to break. Jesse Ventura is our guest. Five more minutes left, and we have the Huffington Post writer that wrote about Hillary's medical problems and got fired, got banned. It just fits into all the censorship. More on the economy and a lot more of your phone calls as well. You got cut off by the break, Governor. Finish up with what you're saying about the Second Amendment or Johnson.
Well, first of all, remember this. Libertarians, and that's who Gary Johnson's the presidential candidate for, believe in the Constitution and the Bill of Rights. So you have no problem with the Second Amendment with Gary Johnson. I don't care who his VP is. Libertarians believe in the Constitution, and they believe in the Bill of Rights, and they hold those two documents sacred. That's all people need to know about Gary Johnson's position on the Second Amendment.
Well, I understand what the libertarians stand for, but politicians, you can go back on what they say a lot of times, so I don't...
Well, that may be true, but Gary Johnson doesn't oppose the Second Amendment. I guarantee it. Anyway, let me go back to a thing in my trial for a moment, Alex.
Yes.
Another truth that wasn't allowed. Okay, 2002, I was put on heparin, Coumadin, blood thinners. I've been on them since 2002, and I'm still on them today. This alleged incident took place in 2006, where I would have been on blood thinners for 4 years. Kyle claimed he hit me, my head went down, struck a curb, and I didn't get up. Well, being on Coumadin, they wouldn't allow me to say that in court because I'm not a doctor. All I could state was I was on blood thinning medication, which could be aspirin. Even though I take it every day and have taken it for 16 frickin' years almost. Well, when we go back to court this time, I'm bringing doctors in who will say exactly that anyone on Coumadin who would be knocked out, hit their head on a curb, would be...
But you're also, you have more witnesses. I mean, your words are in the break. Wait till I win with a second jury because I've got even more witnesses. Bombshell info. Plus, they said that you were drunk. I mean, I've been around you many, many times.
No,
you don't drink.
No. They didn't say I was drunk. Because you can't drink on Coumadin. What it was all of Kyle's witnesses were drunk, but they spent $1,100 on booze. My witnesses were sober, but these two judges chose to believe the drunks rather than the sober people. So I guess these two judges probably figure drunk driving laws are irrelevant because you've got your faculties even when you consume $1,100 worth of booze, which came out in the court case.
He might have gotten so drunk he did think you did all this.
That could be. That may well be.
Blackout drunk. Like, he wakes up. Well, you beat up Jesse Ventura. That's what I did. Whoa.
Exactly. No, that all came out in the case. Every one of their bill that night was $1,100 they spent on alcohol.
And wasn't Kyle the head guy over the booze?
No, I don't know who was.
I went from memory. I
don't really know. I can't.
Well, all I can say is it's a very entertaining movie that Clint Eastwood, and I know you've been a fan of Clint Eastwood a lot,
Well, he's a friend.
Yeah. Yeah, so I'm really, really glad that that part didn't end up in the movie.
Well, it didn't because I'll give you an example during the court case real quick. The other side told me, they said, Mr. Ventura, would you be surprised to find out that your chapter's not in the first screenplay of the movie. And I looked at the other attorney and said, no, I'm not surprised. I said, we've written two letters to Warner Brothers stating that if my chapter's included in the movie, they will be next to be sued. So Warner Brothers, we put them on notice.
No, no, they were saying it like you weren't important. Oh, you're not.
I had to go to court to stop it from being in the movie.
Yeah, they were putting it out like you weren't important. See, you're not in the movie. You're like, yeah, I stopped it.
Yeah, we stopped it. We wrote Warner Brothers, and I've worked in L.A. They don't like to step into lawsuits.
Well, it would ruin the movie, too, to have Jesse Ventura getting beat up in it. It's just total bull.
Oh, you know if I wouldn't have gone to court, it would have been in the movie.
Yeah.
You know it would have.
Well, listen, when's the RT show?
Let me give an example quick, Alex. That book had a pre-sale of, I think, 2,000. And the day Kyle went on TV and libeled me, it jumped 100,000 in one day.
No, no, they used defaming you to sell it. It's wrong. That's why we've always told the truth. We've been proven right. We stood beside you. Governor, come back on soon and talk about your RT show. Thank you.
I sure will when I'm in New York. Bye-bye.
Thank you. People ask me, why are you going up against Hillary Clinton? Why are you really starting and supercharging a global movement against world government? These people have brought down scores of countries. They've murdered millions of people. What are you doing taking on George Soros? He's the guy behind Hillary. What do you got to prove? I'm not doing this to be macho or a tough guy. I'm only doing what I had to do. I cannot physically sit here and watch pure evil overrun everything when it admits it's pure evil. I wouldn't be risking my life if we had boss hog type corruption. I'd be criticizing it. I'd be against it. But I wouldn't be working 7 days a week. I wouldn't be having nightmares about it. I wouldn't be up here risking my life. They're now announcing the end of free speech. That's coming up in the next segment. Notice I just had Ventura on, who I disagree with on about a third of things. Ventura's a smart guy, but he's also very, he'll tell you, blue collar. And he looks at immigrants coming in, feels sorry for them, and says, oh, let them in. He doesn't get them being brought in, politicized, weaponized, signed on the Democratic Party to be used as an underclass. He just likes to, you know, oh, kind of like Trump was, oh, bring the refugees in. They're Christians. They're getting killed. They went, no, so they're only bringing in the Sunnis that are running it all. Well, and they're not checking their IDs. Well, stop them all then until it's fixed. I tell you, Trump is sophisticated, almost idiot savant level, but there's a provincial blue-collarness down there as well. I mean, I've analyzed both these guys, and the establishment is freaking out and backing Gary Johnson. Koch brothers are in there backing him. I don't trust Gary Johnson. And by the way, I've had Gary Johnson on like 10 times. I've had him on like 6-7 times in person, and that got changed about 4 years ago when he'd come in here in the office. The last few times he was in here, and I mean, looking at me and just going on air for the audience, but looking at me like, I was just like, I don't want Johnson. I mean, a few years ago, Johnson wants to come on. I'm like, nah, I don't like Johnson. That gives me the creeps. Notice the media is covering Johnson. They're not covering the Green Party lady because she takes away from Hillary. Trump is the third party taking over the Republicans, and that's a fact. I want to play this clip of our guest that's coming up here because he has been massively censored, David Seaman. Actually, he was a guest on like a long time ago, but he wrote a lot of articles for Huffington Post, and he just, well, here he is talking about it. We're going to go to break playing this clip of, you know, I think we had a computer problem there. It's been glitching.
Huffington Post, where I was a contributor, they have revoked my publishing access, and they have deleted both of my articles that were published earlier over the weekend. Both of my articles have been pulled without notice of any kind, just completely deleted from the internet. And both of those articles mentioned Hillary's health, which is both a hashtag on Twitter, and I linked to a video that a YouTuber, Paul Joseph Watson, had uploaded back on August 4th, showing signs that Hillary Clinton's health is quite poor, showing something that appears to be either a seizure or an involuntary muscle spasm while she's questioned by a number of reporters. And that video since August 4th that that Paul Watson put up has been viewed more than 3.5 million times. So it was a very newsworthy thing for me to link out to. People are talking about it. That hashtag has been quite popular. And whenever a video concerning a presidential candidate's health is viewed more than 3.5 million times, somebody who's under contract to the Huffington Post and to AOL should be able to link out to that, especially as a journalist
living
in the United States
of
America.
We're going to be back. We're going to talk to this gentleman in person straight ahead, but it's all part of a unified program of censorship, which they admit is to be run by the United Nations and George Soros. We have the emails. That's right, a weirdo Nazi collaborator is going to run your life. I will tell you, it is very, very creepy to have a woman who I get triggered by. And by that, I don't go into, you know, feministic spasms or hot flashes or anything. But when I see Hillary Clinton making Joker faces and doing her hyena laugh, And I see her different activities, it upsets me. My blood pressure goes up. I can just see an image of her when they have the website up on screen, and it's upsetting because this is really a bad person. It'd be like if I had a neighbor who I caught robbing my garage twice and who I caught doing other bad stuff. You get irritated seeing that neighbor. I've had neighbors like that. You know they stole your bike. You catch them. They claim they don't know why your bike is in their backyard and their kid's using it. Then you catch them robbing you again. You just move out of the neighborhood. Or you see them move and you go, oh, thank God. And you talk to their landlord and they weren't paying their rent. We had some juvenile delinquent when I was a kid in Dallas. When we moved when I was five. But it was a blue-collar neighborhood, upper, you know, blue-collar, but still blue-collar. And he was robbing stuff and breaking into things. And he finally got arrested. But it was just to see his family deny, he was like four doors down, deny it. His name was Joey. Deny and deny and deny the robberies. And then finally he got busted. It's like Hillary is a criminal who's committed all these crimes. And she's there in front of you. And she won't get out of your life. And she won't go away. And I've got real Hillary Clinton fatigue. They just put her on screen right there. That arrogant Joker face. I mean, I'll be honest, watching that Batman movie with the late actor who played the Joker, he looked so drugged out, so upset, so depressed, so crazy that you find it disquieting. I mean, clowns are disquieting. And that movie irritates me because I don't want to look at the Joker. With Hillary, it's 50 times worse. This woman tortures me. If you wanted to torture me, you'd put me in a cell with TV screens around me with Hillary Clinton giggling like a hyena. And this is who the power structure, who we know is a criminal and has committed all these crimes, and now the Chinese president, she was having people pay for access to him. It just gets worse and worse. It's totally criminal. And what does it say that the mainstream media in unity? The mainstream media is covering up for her in mass, and you will go to the New York Times or CNN.com, and I'm telling you, there'll be 50, 60, 70 articles, every one of them attacking Donald Trump. I'm going to hold my guest till about 45 after, 40 after, and then we can take some calls if folks want to hold. If not, drop off, but I'm going to be able to get your calls for a while. I appreciate you calling in. I'm just have to get to our guest. I covered this in the first hour. I have hundreds of articles that are super important. I'll mention some of these, but really front and center is this. They have a system of internet censorship used in China. It's an internet ID. It's an internet social score where you basically get blacklisted off the web if you criticize the government or global corporations or groups that the system is protecting. The system ends net neutrality, but not just for traffic going over systems, for certain carriers or certain websites or certain outlets. But if you're a patriot, a nationalist, whoever they don't like, you are not allowed to basically even use the internet. DC leaks, website down, Twitter suspended after releasing Soros docs. Daily Caller, linked on Infowars.com. An internet giveaway to the UN. If the U.S. abdicates internet stewardship, the United Nations may take control. They got the FOIA documents. That's what it does. We told you. The UN's been lobbying them for this forever. Soros document, regulate internet to favor open society supporters and only let their information out. Push the NGOs. Force feed it. Just like you get Obama force feeds on your, quote, smartphone or your computer. they actually say you'll get force feeds from the UN and it'll be George Soros. Just like they say the UN's now with strong cities going to direct local police. That's not me embellishing. That's what Loretta Lynch said. It's happening. They're reaching the point of the final construction of this thing. They've already built the foundation and the superstructure. They're loading it up right now. The Pope's meeting with Zuckerberg to discuss all this. It's here. They're globalist Manhattan Project squared. And then you have Huffington Post bans journalist for writing about Hillary's health, deletes article. He's talking about a video that now has 4 million views just on one platform, millions on others. It's been played on Fox News, other channels. It's totally legitimate to cover. He writes an article about it, and they delete it. Again, this just shows how these people operate. There is a criminal instinct, a mob instinct of what you call leftists now that is as far from liberal values this country or world's ever seen. They're about as liberal as a mouse to tongue. That's their, in fact, that's who's popular on the college campuses, but all funded by weirdo rich billionaires that want monopolies, overthrow countries, starve people, put radical jihadis in charge, and you tell the little trendies this, they don't care because they go, I'm with it, even though they're delusional and aren't with it. We have a new Mark Dice video on Infowars.com. Then we're going to our guest. Mark Dice goes out and every idiot he talks to doesn't even know who the vice president is. But they say they're Democrats, so they're intellectual. These people can't find their butts with both hands. But let me tell you something. They know how to run your life. They wreck California. They come to Austin. They're so stupid, they don't even know why they're fleeing the place they have soiled. Our guest, one more journalist, written scores of articles over the years for the Huffington Post, been a guest on with us in 2014 in September. Thought criminal, David Seaman. He joins us to talk about this. And, of course, there are plenty of stories about McCain's health, plenty of stories about Donald Trump's health, mental health. You can say he's crazy all over the news with no evidence. But he joins us. David Seaman, thanks for coming on. This is the season of the rollout of censorship. Am I wrong? Talk about what happened to you.
Yeah, thank you for having me on, Alex. And thank you for being one of the first and one of the biggest news sites to cover this, along with a few others. We Are Change got out there front and center as well. But InfoWars was definitely one of them. And when this happened to me, it didn't feel good. You know, there was like a pit in my stomach because this is what I do for a living. I'm a journalist, I'm a pundit, I'm a researcher. For people who haven't been following me much, I used to appear on a bunch of cable shows and shoots. I was on CNN programs often. Anderson Cooper once gave me career advice on the air. I was on Wolf Blitzer, where they played a video of me on Wolf Blitzer that Valerie Jarrett had to respond to, where I was saying that Obama's performance I would rate as a D or an F, and this was some years ago. But I used to go on Fox News every once in a while, so I'm just a media pundit. I'm just a guy who does this stuff. And I've been doing online media for years, and I've never seen anything like this where your articles are deleted without any prior discussion from an editor who manages you, just deleted late on a Sunday night, and then you log in and your account has been completely revoked.
The gloves are off. I mean, have you ever seen media as just a solid wall of disinformation act like this? I'm really impressed by their discipline. I mean, this is Nazi-like.
Well, the reason why I immediately put out a video explaining what had happened, and I put it on my personal YouTube channel, and although the views are, as you know yourself, the views are staggered, the public views, but when I log in, the actual number of views since yesterday is 67,000 views. And so that gave me a lot of confidence that I have some personal safety because I wanted to get the truth out there. It would be very simple after being so dishonest that you would delete two articles that are completely factually correct, completely grammatically correct, nothing offensive to minorities, no profane language, not trying to step on anybody's toes, but, you know, bringing up the subject of Hillary Clinton's health and linking out to that video, which has been viewed millions of times, not even my own video, not even my own content or research. It's pretty much just firsthand footage of Mrs. Clinton and of that head spasm or seizure or whatever the experts deem it to be, whatever that is and whatever those other montages were, they are certainly not normal, right? So that's all I was doing is raising a bit of awareness with a couple of quick posts that took me 20 minutes. And I had no idea that my publishing privileges would be revoked. And there's a real impact on me professionally, because not only does it look reputationally bad to be promoting an article that people click on and see it's been deleted and censored away, now I can no longer go to certain conferences, and it's going to be harder to get access to certain sources because I no longer...
Well, it's okay, because what happens is, like Cheryl Atkinson getting fired from CBS, you get another job. Maybe we should have you do some contract work for us. We're going to come right back from break with David Seaman. I've written tons of articles for Huffington Post over the years, censored for just saying, hey, look at this viral video. That's what news is supposed to be, is, hey, this is a big story. What do you think about this? Let's go out to break showing a clip of Hillary's real health.
No, you okay? Keep talking. You handle it.
She looks profoundly mentally ill there. And it's okay. It's all right. It's all right. Somebody said something to you in the crowd. We'll be back.
Since my video went viral and catapulted Hillary's health back into the national spotlight, we've seen more examples of Clinton behaving bizarrely, completely losing her wits mid-sentence.
We need to make what we've got work really well and improve it and get the costs out of an upward spiral of... an upward spiral.
Nearly falling over again. Referring to Trump as her husband.
You will compare what I'm proposing to what my opponent is talking about.
Having to be calmed by a mysterious Secret Service agent. Who also carries around a weird syringe, which some speculate carries an anti-seizure drug. The reemergence of photos from February.
All right, let's
Hillary
start fading that down. That's
stairs.
Another one of his latest viral videos. There's three or four of them. They've got tens of millions of views total. We have some breaking news. I'll keep Mr. Seaman with us into the next segment. During the break, Buckley came in and said, hey, what do you want to do about this? Motherboard, The Hill, they're all calling you. And I instantly saw what it was, went and talked to our IT people and our hacker specialist folks that report on hacking, not hackers, even though we just get the Stingray documents and everything else. But the point is that in 2012, it was actually a year before that, we'd know about it for a while, somebody was able to get in and get some real emails of people that had signed up on prisonplanet.tv. But that was it. And then they mixed in a bunch of names and other stuff with it and put it out. And of course, we just told folks about it and it was a patch and no big deal, thank God. And thank God most hackers are white hat folks that are actually out there exposing, you know, the climate gate and Hillary and George Soros and how they stole the election from Bernie Sanders and so much more. But I tell you, the story here is that Motherboard and others got trolled. They're putting this out that this just happened. This happened actually in 2011, and we reported on it in 2012. So that's what's going on. This is how desperate they are to shut us down, how desperate they are to engage in economic warfare and try to stir up trouble. And it's why it's more important than ever. Flood the site with support. Spread the word about our articles and videos. Buy the Hillary for Prison shirts at cost right now. Shipping and handling and the shirt, $9.95, no shipping added. Get BioTrue selenium. From our research, the very best, most organic selenium anybody can get out there. It's so important in the body. We've got the vitamin mineral fusion, amino acid fruit punch that's so important that you give to yourself and your family and others. That's 20% off right now. At InfoWarsLife.com or InfoWarsStore.com. This is what I'm trying to explain to people. This is an all-out war going on right now. Going back to a victim of this, where are you going from here now that you dare report on a video that even CNN was reporting on, but you're the little minion? You're not allowed to actually talk about it. You'd think the Huffington Post would actually want the traffic generated off of that, but they have a scorched earth policy now of censorship. What do you make of George Soros' emails coming out that he wants the UN and others to control the web and not let those of us that disagree with them have access and give special treatment to his news organizations like the Huffington Post? It's right here.
Well, I don't know much about the Soros Foundation or him in particular, but I can tell you that my experience with Huffington Post, especially given the fact that they have been so liberal with me, the traditional version of the word liberal. They've been so liberal in what they've allowed me to publish. And I primarily cover cryptocurrency and gold and sound money stuff. I'm interested in Bitcoin and some of the newer crypto networks like Ethereum that people think will eventually be able to outdo, possibly things like Bitcoin will be able to somehow outdo the corrupt centralized content silos like Facebook, where we all have to store our information and interact with each other, where we're not making any money off of that stuff and where our information is being divulged to, you know, God knows what number of agencies and governments and even corporations. So that was my focus. This was just a couple of quick posts, and I was blown away that that's the end of your career. That, like, that's the level of arrogance. As you were saying in the last break, there is a level of just contempt for the average person. Like, I'm just some journalist. We'll just run you over, and you don't have a career anymore. You look like a joke. We'll move on to the next person. We'll find somebody in their early 20s, and they'll write this crap moving forward. And that's really toxic. That's really not what America's about. That's not America's heritage journalism-wise when you go back to people like Edward R. Murrow.
That's right. The tyrants are making their move.
The First Amendment.
That's right. Stay there. I'm going to come back and give you the floor for about 5 minutes to roll with all this. David Seaman, a victim of the massive censorship that is taking place, ladies and gentlemen, because he dared talk about reality and say, look at this big story. It's in mainstream news about Hillary's health. And they're like, bye-bye, down the rabbit hole. This is how they operate, and it's only going to get worse. I want to talk about how we counter this with David Seaman straight ahead. I'm Alex Jones with InfoWars.com. Visit it while you still can. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm sitting here during the break trying to think of words strong enough to describe what we're watching. We're watching a new kind of war, 21st century technocratic, pre-programmed systems of censorship and control, and we have the emails and the admissions and the New York Times telling Facebook, censor more, kill Donald Trump. I mean, it's all happening. We're seeing a true authoritarian instinct from the so-called left, which I know can manifest in the right as well. I'm a libertarian. Even Libertarian Party's getting taken over right now by the globalist. And our guest, David Seaman, has been kicked off the Huffington Post for simply talking about the fact that Hillary Clinton's health or non-health issues is one of the biggest stories in the country. That's newsworthy, even if you disagree with it or agree with it. Even though he conformed to writing it very dryly, that wasn't enough. You've got to go along with their agenda. And then it comes out that Dr. Drew, why was Dr. Drew fired, was the number one Google search last week. Because people now know he was fired for saying, I'm worried about Hillary. You know, she looks bad. And what she's got, the drugs they say they're giving her, it'll kill you. You're not supposed to take them together. So going back to our guest to finish up his points, go ahead, David Seaman.
Yeah, Dr. Drew in particular has been with CNN for so long. I think his show has been running for 6 years. And then, you know, I grew up listening to him on Loveline. He and Adam Carolla had a radio show. So to just boot Dr. Drew off the air like that, when what he said was, I thought, quite coherent. You know, the guy is a medical professional. And don't you want a medical expert to sound off on this stuff and not just people like me? You know, it makes sense to want to hear what Dr. Drew would have to say. But anyway, before the break, you'd asked me, I think, like, what can we do about this stuff? And I have no idea, really. Obviously, you know, I'm becoming more and more a supporter of Trump because I don't see the same kind of manipulation coming out of his campaign. And as I joked on Twitter, half joked anyways, even when I criticize Donald Trump, I don't have any fear that he's going to try to kill me or he's going to try to, you know, mangle my career in some way or slow me down. As we've seen, if Donald Trump doesn't like you, he just calls you out on Twitter, on social media, and then picks the bones clean. You know, he will completely destroy you, but he's not in the business of stacking up a body count. And I got some very disturbing messages last night from people who I think some were genuinely concerned about my health and well-being after that whole thing. But some people, it seemed like psychological harassment almost, or it was like, oh, you poor little thing.
Look, I had Jimmy Kimmel come out and say the New World Order is basically going to kill you, Alex Jones, and make it a joke. But he just had a mass murderer on days before who he was defending. See, they're getting off on the idea of tyranny, David. So your instinct is absolutely right.
Yeah, I think at least 10 to 20% of these messages were what I construed as harassment. It's all happening. You know, I used to think that people like you were crazy, and then gradually I came to the conclusion that you're some of the few people doing real journalism in the United States anymore. Because CNN, that laughing clip of Hillary that you played earlier from Paul Watson's video, that laughing clip of her on CNN, that was Jake Tapper who interviewed her. And as kind of lightweight and useless as that interview was, how useful is it to just have 30 seconds of somebody laughing in such a shrill way? As useless as that sit down was to begin with, it's to sit down with a compromised person. You know, in the DNC leaks that WikiLeaks came out with, you know, I'd argue that the lack of coverage of this latest WikiLeaks batch is probably the biggest news story in the country at the moment. In addition,
it's one of the biggest in a decade. But what's even bigger is that the media is totally ignoring it or spinning it when it's so bombshell, and unified lying is really, it's so lockstep. It's horrifying.
It is horrifying. It makes you feel like you're on the outside looking in. And with, you know, Jake Tapper, the nature of that relationship, there he is right there. That's Jake Tapper waving his hand with the sheet of paper. Based on the WikiLeaks emails, he should be out of a job. They can fill that show with somebody else very quickly. He is not irreplaceable. He should be out of a job. He is compromised, or his producers are compromised. But it's inappropriate to already be that close with the DNC and then to host an interview where the only question posed is to let her just laugh until the time runs out. She runs out the clock with that absurd laughter. And, you know, there are a lot of people like me who are not going to put our careers ahead of what's right anymore. We're just going to say it as we see it. And it's clear that something is going on.
I was about to say, just like when the Nazis started bombing civilian targets, they thought it would make the British give up. It made the British go from not wanting to be in the war to wanting to go into the war. And I don't know why tyrants from Tokyo Rose to Hillary Clinton think threatening people, talking about my dark heart, trying to sick her, you know, minions on me, how she thinks is going to make me give up. It's only going to make me fight that much harder and have more energy. I mean, they don't get it. We know you're a mass murderer, Hillary. We know you're a killer. Some of us have to stand up. And now you've made it so clear for us. There's really, you know, no mistake. Well, listen, I want you to go on doing your journalism, do it on your own, you know, as the censored person, submit pieces to InfoWars. We'd love to carry it. Let us talk to you the next few days about, you know, doing some work with us. And, you know, that's how you counter these people, is we build our own systems. Just like Matt Drudge said, we get out of their internet ghettos. We get out of their systems. I understand using them for a while because they've kind of given themselves the attention, but we're already bigger than they are overall. Let's leave Babylon. Let's come out of Egypt. David Seaman, we'll talk to you again soon.
Thank you, and I would love to take you up on that offer.
It's you bet. We'll be calling you today. That's a great idea. We're trying to get a few auxiliary folks. They don't have a big budget, but we do have paid people here, and we're trying to hire a few more writers and reporters that want to just report on news and have integrity. We don't even micromanage what you say. Just don't attack little people. Cover big stories. Investigative journalism, we got to review it. But if you're just commentating on big news stories out there, that's what we're looking for. Now, I'm going to play this piece, then come back and take calls if you want to hold. But I've got to air it. I aired it yesterday. It's so important. Alex Jones asked Hillary Clinton not to kill him. That's the headline they gave it on the website. Really, it's I said to Hillary Clinton, please stop killing people. Or you could say, this is the video Hillary Clinton doesn't want you to see. We're going to get to it in just a moment. But please understand, never before is it more clear to everyone. I've known that InfoWars has been the tip of the spear because I was the only one, I guess, with the type of platform and who was willing to do it. Because it's not even a courage issue. It kind of sounds nasty to say all this stuff, even though it's true. It's almost like cuss words, the things we talk about. I get it. It's obscene. I'm not doing it. I'm reporting on what's happening. It's still an obscene program. I get it. But truth is truth. And now, I've known we've been the tip of the spear for 10 years at least. Okay, tip of the spear. Only thing more effective in punching through was Drudge. Now Drudge, working, you know, linking to our stories, changes history. And now you see everybody else going our direction. That's why the system's panicking. We're mainlining reality. We broke through the confidence game that there's no world government and none of this is happening. We need your support, though. Your prayers, spreading the words about the links, the videos, everything. I'm risking my life to do this. I don't want to do it and fail. I know we can win. You can win. Hillary for prison shirts at cost, InfoWarsStore.com, Operation Darkheart, making a joke off what she said about me last week. 20% off on the vitamin mineral fruit punch, multivitamin. We've got a lot of other specials running right now on InfoWarsLife.com or InfoWarsStore.com. And it's your purchases that allow me to, quite frankly, get more reporters, anchors, and people in place in case Hillary does kill me. And the media, notice, hadn't made jokes about this yet, because everybody knows the Clintons want people to know they're killers. okay, that are informed, and then make their sheep, you know, just think it's a joke. I'm just pointing out to Hillary that I'm conscious of that to steal her enjoyment if she decides or her minions decide to pull something. Because what they do is they put out kind of the verbal attack on who's giving them problems, like who will get rid of this person for me, who will take care of this problem, and then it happens. The problem is you kill Spartacus, 10,000 more stand up and say, I am Spartacus, Hillary. I mean, you have your mentor that pledged himself to Lucifer. You're a freak, and somebody's got to say no to you. So please support us, InfoWarsStore.com. The new film, Armageddon, is also out as well. We're going to go ahead and go to this report. Hillary Clinton, again, please stop killing people.
Before the Clintons left their governorship in Arkansas, more than 100 people had been suspiciously murdered. Hundreds more died during their first terms, and the scourge continues to this day. DNC staffer after DNC staffer that speaks out against election fraud or leaks information to WikiLeaks ends up gunned down. And the Clinton crime family and their backers is now in the spotlight. If I die, if they kill me, it was done for a worthy cause. Somebody's got to stand up against these people. Long before George W. Bush had taken office, or Senator Obama was even thinking about being president, I was there, exposing the crimes of the Clintons. So it is fitting that I, Alex Jones, called the Dark Heart by Hillary Clinton, would be your chronicler. A chronicler who risked his very life exposing these evil ones.
It's required by Bill Clinton in 1992, and it was instituted here in Texas in 1993. I know the code, sir. Are you going to institute his urine and blood testing when he commands you? Are you going to stick a needle in my arm when I have no criminal record?
It's also what happens when you listen to the radio host, Alex Jones, who claims that 9/11 and the Oklahoma City bombings were inside jobs.
Just a few days ago, Hillary Clinton, one of the most powerful criminal kingpins in history, came out on national television and said that I had a horrible dark heart.
I don't know what happens in somebody's mind or how dark their heart must be.
I am committed to standing up against oppression and tyranny. That's just who I am. But I've got to be honest with you. I thought back to the history of the Clintons' reign of criminal terror in the last 20-plus years on this planet, and I have to tell you, it's surreal to realize that Alex Jones, little old me, is one of the main opposition points against these monsters.
It's also what happens when you listen to the radio host, Alex Jones, who claims that 9/11 and the Oklahoma City bombings were inside jobs.
Hillary Clinton is famous for her death threats, both public and private. Back in 2008, even the New York Times had the headline, Clinton's remark on Kennedy's killing stirs uproar. When Obama was way ahead of her in the primary polls, she said it doesn't matter because Bobby got assassinated before the primary ended.
Now, my husband did not wrap up the nomination in 1992 until he won the California primary somewhere in the middle of June, right? We all remember Bobby Kennedy was assassinated in June in California.
This is the type of bloodthirsty rhetoric that we continually see from Hillary Clinton. Years later, after she had successfully conned the world into bombing Libya to give Al-Qaeda air cover, Hillary, after landing in Tripoli, bragged that she came, she saw, and Gaddafi died.
Yes, we came, we saw, he died.
Did it have anything to do with your visit?
No, I'm sure it did.
I want to go back to the beginning. Governor Bill Clinton and his co-governor wife supported George Herbert Walker Bush in the 1991 war in Iraq. But from there, it only got worse. Once they were in the White House, they expanded the bombing to hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of attacks a year on the infrastructure of Iraq. They got the UN to pass their most draconian
sanctions ever in modern history where medicine and food and all forms of technology were basically blocked from coming into the country. Over 1.5 million Iraqis starved to death and died. And Hillary Clinton's mentor, Madeleine Albright, bragged on 60 Minutes and other channels that 500,000 dead Iraqi children were a good price to pay of the sanctions.
We have heard that 500,000 children have died. I mean, that's more children than died in Hiroshima. And you know, is the price worth it?
I think this is a very hard choice, but we think the price is worth it.
The population implodes. Refugees flee across the world. A once pro-Western secular Muslim nation had begun its path to being taken over by jihadis, which Hillary, a decade plus later, would facilitate in happening.
I mean, let's remember here, the people we are fighting today, we funded 20 years ago.
Let's go back again to 1995 and 1999. You have the Croats, you have the Serbs, you have the Muslims in the south in Albania, you have the Balkans. The Russians have pulled out after the fall of the Soviet Union in 1991. The Clintons back Islamicist out of Albania and Croats, this is on record, to attack Serbia. When Serbia fights back, even though they lost twice as many people, the Clintons launch giant bombing raids and NATO invasions that blow up power plants, water treatment plants, TV stations with depleted uranium bombs radiating the entire area. Then they had British television broadcast images of what's admitted now to be fake Serb concentration camps. The Clintons are the most hated couple in Serbia and the Balkans because the Serbs were the most powerful allies of America. And Madeleine Albright, the Secretary of State who ran this whole operation that bragged about 500,000 kids is no big deal. Her father and her were saved from the Nazis by the Serbs.
A lot of you younger women don't think you have to, it's been done. It's not done. And you have to help. Hillary Clinton will always be there for you. And just remember, there's a special place in hell for women who don't help each other.
But when you are a Machiavellian sociopath or a sadistic psychopath like George Soros, Hillary Clinton, Bill Clinton, and others, you don't look at things about alliances and who's right and who's wrong. You look at 1 billion plus Muslims, and you look at Syria, and you look at the invasion points where you can come into all of Europe and take over. But first, you've got to get the weapons to invade. And you see Libya and Muammar Gaddafi, who for 8 years previous to the Western attack had invested in the West, brought the West in, and decided to go the route of detente. He was set up. Jihadists out of Saudi Arabia via the State Department and Hillary, this is all mainstream news now, were brought into Benghazi. They attacked the country. The West had a bombing campaign to back the takeover. Islamists were put in control. Christians, blacks, non-radical Muslims, Shiites, and others were killed by the tens of thousands. And Hillary formed, by design, a failed state.
We came, we saw, he died.
You look at the before and after images, it is simply incredible. And Hillary admits it's a failed state. They took the weapons, the Stinger missiles, the TOW missiles, and moved them to Syria to knock down the gates to Europe. You take over Syria, you can bring in all the jihadis out of Saudi Arabia and other areas, invade Europe, then use the Islamic threat to ban free speech of those that criticize it, and use the civil emergency to bring in a permanent form of martial law. To be fair to Hillary Clinton, she's only a puppet of George Soros, who even the Jerusalem Post has recently reported, due to the WikiLeaks documents, is nothing but a megalomaniac who thinks he's the Messiah, establishing world government through chaos he sows.
First, on Ukraine, one of the things that many people recognized about you was that you, during the revolutions of 1989, funded a lot of dissident activity, civil society groups in Eastern Europe, in Poland, the Czech Republic. Are you doing similar things in Ukraine?
Well, I set up a foundation in Ukraine before Ukraine became independent of Russia. And the foundation has been functioning ever since. And it played an important part in events now.
Do you?
It would take hours to chronicle the hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of people that have been mysteriously murdered, gunned down, choked to death, drowned, cut into pieces since the Clintons were running for governor, right through president, right through the State Department to today. But just since Bernie Sanders openly had the nomination stolen from him a few months ago, we've seen at least four top staffers over email, over servers, over all the key information being gunned down, being killed, being murdered. And WikiLeaks has come out and said, we don't reveal sources, but this is an alleged source, and we have put on a $20,000 reward. This is getting really, really out of control.
The stuff that you're sitting on, is an October surprise in there? Do you even know what you're sitting on?
WikiLeaks never sits on material. Our whistleblowers go to significant efforts to get us material and often very significant risks. As a 27-year-old who works for the DNC, who was shot in the back, murdered just 2 weeks ago for unknown reasons as he was walking down the street in Washington. So
That was just a robbery, I believe, wasn't it?
No, there's no finding. So
What are you suggesting?
I'm suggesting that our sources take risks, and they become concerned to see things occurring like that.
But was he one of your sources then? I mean,
we don't comment on who our sources
but
are.
Why make the suggestion about a young guy being shot in the streets of Washington?
Because we have to understand how high the stakes are.
Google has been caught, so have Facebook, Twitter, you name it, censoring anti-news stories about the Clintons, including the Clinton death count. We are seeing what the technocracy is able to do. We are seeing them openly engage in mass censorship.
What difference at this point does it make?
In closing, I want to reach out to you with a personal appeal, a free human to other free humans of every race, color, and creed who have the spirit of liberty beating in your breast. I don't want to confront a kingpin that's killed millions of people around the world and who thinks it's funny. I don't want to take on this vampire. I don't want to fight this monster as an individual. But as a man, my spirit directs me, commands me to take action. I don't have any other choice. And I want to be victorious and successful in this quest. Evil, historically, takes over and is unstoppable as long as good men and women do nothing. But as Thomas Jefferson famously said, our third president, when we take action, nothing on earth can stop us. That's why tyrants are so scared of good men and women who actually have goodwill and want you to have free will, and who want universal law to reign on this planet. We're facing cancer. That's what Hillary Clinton represents, evil. She represents chaos. She represents lawlessness. She represents disease and failure. Her physical manifestation is a rotting, reanimated corpse. I'm not scared of Hillary Clinton, but I am scared of failing in this mission. So I ask you all to redouble your efforts to expose the New World Order. And I ask you all for your prayers. And I reach out to Hillary Clinton as well, because I don't even personally hate her. I hate the spirit that has taken over her body, her mind, and her soul. There's still time for you to turn back, Hillary. You talk about my dark heart and then misrepresent what I've said. I have a heart of incredible love. I care deeply for people, and I even care for what's left of you. You wouldn't have said the things you said on that podium unless there wasn't some shred of humanity left in you. There's still time for you and others to turn back. But I want to be very, very clear. I have chosen the path I'm on, and I am willfully challenging you and everything that you represent. And I'm asking the population of this planet and those that love liberty to support us and to pray for us. And I'm telling you and your masters that I'm only one symbol of freedom, one manifestation, and that nothing on earth will stop the movement that you now see. It's time for Hillary Clinton to repent. It's time for Hillary Clinton to stop the murder, to stop the killing, to stop licking her lips like Madeleine Albright and herself when they talk about all the dead kids. I look at how you put in jihadis and Al-Qaeda into Libya and into Syria to kill hundreds of thousands of Christians, and Obama won't let the Christians get out, but lets the Sunnis that engage in the crime escape. And I just thank God I'm not on your team. So whatever you do to me, that's between you and God. But I've made my choice, and I am not with you. I will never commit suicide, and if I am killed, the criminals that represent Hillary Rodham Clinton are the main suspects. You may have the old rotten, discredited mainstream media that the AP says has a 6% trust rate with the public backing you, Hillary. But I've got common sense and the will of the people behind me. And I'm committed to a cause. And in history and in this universe, nothing on earth can stand up against that. No matter what happens to this body, ideas and movements backed by truth and liberty are invincible. They are bulletproof.
This is the heart of 1776.
I tell you, I wouldn't have it any other way. Reality is so exhilarating, amazing, overwhelming. But thank God we're not with those timid souls that crouch down and lick the hands that feed them, may their chains set lightly upon them. But as for us, that is not our fate, to paraphrase Patrick Henry. Now, I want to hand the baton to David Knight. Come up here in about 6 minutes. Let's go to Preston and James, who held like real troopers. Preston wants to talk from Minnesota about UN takeover of the net, which is official. Told people about it years ago. It's like, oh, it never happened. Now they're like, oh, we did the FOIA documents. Yeah, the UN's going to run it, and George Soros will be in control of that. James in Alabama and others. Go ahead, Preston.
Alex?
Yes, sir.
Hi, Alex. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
First of all, thank you for what you're doing for us.
Thank you, brother.
It's amazing. But second of all, I want to ask you, see, if come October 1st, say this operation isn't here or Drudge Report isn't here because of the UN takeover of the internet, who are we supposed to listen to? I mean, that's...
Well, it's beyond that. I mean, they're just starting regulations and court cases and suing people and attorney generals indicting folks or having grand juries do it who say man-made global warming isn't right. It'll be like 1937 Germany. Took 5-6 years to really get going, and then the gloves are off, and it just goes into... They'll never call it censorship. In their emails, they do, but internet IDs, regulations, control, it's kind of like they're going to bring driverless cars in and then phase us out, they admit, with insurance costs. I mean, I read that 20 years ago. Now they're starting it. It's always incremental. They never want to give us a chance to struggle or actually have victories, so they do it by stealth, but they've taken Fox over. They're censoring all over the web. They're kicking people off Facebook and Twitter that, you know, even talk about anything decent. So I'd say they're really expanding it fast. I'm going to ask David Knight that question when we come back from break and then hand the baton to him. But that's a great question, Preston.
Thanks.
Thank you, brother. I mean, what it is you have the internet registration domain name, which then controls the DNS and how the internet basically operates and who can have what and who can have a piece of the web on their own, who isn't part of a big combine, an internet ghetto, as Drudge says, like Facebook, Twitter, Google. And then they have internet ID that's going to be a thumbprint on the keyboard or your phone. And they talked about that again 20 years ago when I was first getting on air. They said you'll have to thumbprint to get on the internet. Be like, oh, that's crazy. Well, now look at the iPhones. This is here. This is happening. James in Alabama, you're on the air. You want to talk about TPP?
Yes, sir. That's correct. Just want to say I'm a first-time caller. I've been listening to you for about 3 years. I just love what you're doing. Love getting your information. All of it's been proven. You've been proven to be vindicated. But with the TPP, I've done a lot of research recently about it. I mean, doesn't that kind of call it, like, tie into what your last caller was talking about with the internet control, and that if Hillary gets in, she's definitely going to approve it, and that literally gives power over to the multinational corporations?
Oh, it legalizes slavery? We finally got it thousands of pages after they ratified it and now claim it's law globally. Congress says they're going to pretty much pass it. And it just absolutely is worse than we even thought. It's totally insane. Legalizes slavery. Actually says you can have people chained up as slaves in factories and not let them go.
You could maybe in the next couple of weeks or something, just do like a show about the TPP.
You bet. We should go over the worst elements of the TPP. So I mean, there's 30-something sections, and I mean, it's. I mean, I've read. You know, as WikiLeaks was dibbling them out, I read the sections. Once it kind of all came out, there was like more than 20 sections I hadn't read, and it's just vomitous to read. But yeah, we should do a report on that.
All right, man. Well, I appreciate it, and you are the tip of the spear, and I listen to you all the time, man, and I'm going to keep spreading the word and buying the products, and you are truly awesome.
Well, God bless you, brother. You are funding our operation, and so you're just as important as I am or David or anybody. But we're going to go to break, come back, and get some final comments for myself, then hand the baton to David. But, man, 20-something years ago, I go to the library and find a David Rockefeller quote about world government, how Mao Zedong was great, had run down to the TV station, show everybody, look, here's the proof. Now it's like you read TPP and it's like every paragraph's total proof, and then no one, it's not that people even care, it's like, what do you do? It's like stacks and stacks of proof, and it's total tyranny and censorship and evil, and they're going to break our families up, and they're going to forcibly inoculate us, and it's just horrible. You know, I've studied the United Nations, I've studied the OECD that set it up. That was a private banking consortium headed up by the Rockefellers, the Rothschilds, the House of Windsor. And the, I guess, the House of Orange, that's the Dutch royalty, the cousins. And when they took Europe over during its reconstruction, they just basically run the place, just like Japan since then. And so when I read the Wall Street Journal or Daily Caller, who are doing great jobs reporting on this, I see what's hiding in plain view. An internet giveaway to the UN. If the U.S. abdicates internet stewardship, the United Nations might take control. It might take control? When the Obama administration announced, see, because it would sound too conspiratorial to say it is, even though it is. Because, see, they pre-inoculate you that this wasn't happening all the years, so it's like going out on a limb to even admit it could happen as it is happening. When the Obama administration announced its plan to give up U.S. protection of the internet, it promised the United Nations would never take control. But because of the administration's naivete, oh, I'm sure, or arrogance, oh, or how about criminal intent, U.N. control is a likely result if the U.S. gives up internet stewardship as planned at midnight on September 30th. We're talking a month out now. Oh, my gosh. How many days of the election? 70 days to the election. T-minus 31 days until the internet is taken. And of course, they'll be on CNN going, the UN was supposed to take over, but it's October 1st and the internet's still there. There's no censorship. I just have stacks every day as they just warm up the testing all over the world. Arrest people in Germany and France and Sweden. Hire former Stasi brigade commanders to run Facebook, tattling to the police. Zuckerberg meets with Merkel. Oh, don't worry, we'll crack down soon, my darling. You read this article. Of course, I know about the ICANN agreement, the UN agreement. I remember 10 years ago when they started this program, the agreement's already been made. Now let's expand. Daily Caller gets it right. They're the ones digging through the thousands of Soros emails, thanks to DC leaks, which just got censored. Soros document, regulate internet to favor open society supporters. Once you read it, he says the UN's going to run it, and that NGOs like Open Society signed up with the UN to get preferential treatment, placement, and pushing, and that extremism should be filtered out, which they're already doing. Extremism. Alexa, 2 years ago, took tens of thousands of libertarian, patriot, conservative, veterans' rights groups, gun groups, anything that was just not total communist, you know, run by a Nazi collaborator, crazy. I mean, that's what it is. Anything not open society just went 80% drop in the supposed traffic we have. Our traffic's only going straight up. They just say we don't even exist. It's everywhere. Dr. Drew's fired in less than a week for saying Hillary looks really sick. I've looked at her record. Just the drug she's on would kill anybody. And here they are. But see, this should say UN takeover, because it's NGOs regulated by the internet. And then TPP only expands the authorization of this. And of course, they do have related UN internet agenda tied to George Soros. So they do get it. It's just that the headline should be even more hardcore. We should do a story. How the UN takeover of the web is now commencing with George Soros at its head. And so Hillary comes out 2 weeks ago in an email raising money from Hillary Clinton. We showed the articles. It's been mainstream news. And says, we're not going to tolerate the alt-right. And who is the alt-right? Breitbart. Lead elephant heading up the Trump campaign. Then she goes and gives a speech. Goes after Breitbart. Goes after people they know aren't ubiquitous as Drudge. People like Drudge. Even liberals like Drudge. That Drudge is like the biggest newspaper out there. So we're not going to get rid of Drudge. Of course, that's their main target, because people know that sounds kind of like a little too loved, too well known. Let's go after Alex Jones. Let's go after Breitbart. Let's go after and then misconstrue what we say. Say Bannon's this big racist, you know, and now, of course, Trump's KKK. This is the desperateness, but it shows they're really moving into this phase. David Knight, what do you make of all of this? Do you concur, or what would you add as I hand the baton to you? I mean,
well, yeah, Alex, you know, when you talk about the alt-right, who is the alt-right? It's whoever Hillary Clinton says it is. They define the terms, and then they ban the people that they put into those categories. And when we talk about what's going on with the TPP and the TTIP, the worst part about it, I mean, there's a lot of specifics we could talk about, and it is a huge document, but here's the only thing that you really need to know. As Senator Sessions, who did look at this in detail, who is an experienced lawyer, and he prepared a presentation for his fellow members in the Senate who could care less. They didn't bother to even look at the document. They didn't listen to his preparation. But here's the key point, Alex. The TPP, the TTIP are living documents. Now, what does that mean? That means that no matter what these 6,000 pages say,
means they're open-ended power grabs.
Exactly. Tomorrow, the small committee of unelected, unaccountable people that's going to be not necessarily even any Americans.
Just like Obamacare is a committee, exactly. And an open, and now they're saying, oh, guess what? Insurance companies are going to quadruple charge and create monopolies and not allow competition in your state. Oh, in fact, 16 states don't even have competition now. Oh, it's going to help the consumer. Oh, it's so liberal. I'm sorry, David, you're absolutely right.
Yeah, well, that's one aspect of it, is that they can change anything that they want to at will without ever going back and getting any further approval from any of the governments that give them a rubber stamp. And here's the other thing, Alex. Part two of that is that they can include and add any nation that they wish to that, which is the way it's being sold to us. TPP is being sold to us as a means of checking China. China is not part of the TPP right now, and Trump got hit when he talked about China. But he understands, because he's been talking to Senator Sessions, that China could be added the day after they approve this. There's absolutely no way to keep them out of the
agreement.
Just
like they said they never add China to the WTO.
Yeah, exactly. So the whole thing is nothing more than turning over the management of our economy to a small committee of unelected people who are going to control it, just as you had the European Commission controlling the fishing rights off of British
waters. Here's my question for you, then I'm going to hand the baton to you, David. What do you make of the massive intensification of censorship globally, not just here? Is this a test to see what we'll do? There should be congressional hearings. There should be a massive uproar over this.
Well, Alex, as you know, the most important thing that we've got going, it's not the only thing we've got going. The most important thing we've got going is our ability to share information and to expose what they're doing. Hillary talks about the dark corners of the net. No, the net is there to expose light on her dark transactions that she does everything, breaks every law to try to hide. And so they have to get control of the internet. It is truly the high ground. Political speech is the high ground in politics. If you can control the narrative, if you can tell people what's going on without any competition, you create the reality in their minds, and you can hide anything that you want without criticism. We're seeing that right now. We're seeing the establishment press. We're seeing the establishment political parties of both sides.
And more they're saying
Trump.
Arrest climate deniers, arrest yes. In the family. I mean, I think they're really trying to normalize their agenda because it's in trouble. I think we're beginning to see major cracks in their whole organization and agencies and patriots leaking more and more info. I think they've gone too far, David. I think they've proven our case for us. I think that they are on the wrong side of history. And the fact that patriots for decades exposed their agenda, that it's now going to be dead on arrival. I'm going to hand the baton to you. Thank you, David Knight.
Thank you, Alex. And you know, we can see that whenever we go to these rallies that they have, just as we did with the abortionists. What do they want to do? They want to stand there with black signs. They had absolutely nothing to say when we were protesting the abortion clinic here in Austin. They had nothing to say. They came up with black signs to try to redact publicly on the sidewalk what we were saying. They didn't want to counter it. They didn't want to argue with it. And we've seen this happen with the vaccination, with the film Vaxxed, with the Tribeca Film Festival. There was other filmmakers who actually came out and said, we want this film silenced. We want it censored. So now you have the press, especially those in the art community, who have always held the First Amendment as a sacred, untouchable thing. And now they're going around at various film festivals, whether it's a film about vaccinations, Vaxxed, or whether it is the film. I just talked to Mark Hall about his film looking at charter schools and worst case examples of that, with the Fethullah Gulen network here getting $500 million per year of taxpayer money to run schools that they've got a network of 1,000 schools all over the world. The other schools outside of America, of course, are explicitly Islamic. And so we look at these various documentaries like Mark Hall's documentary Killing Ed. They want to keep it out of the film festivals. They don't want to have a discussion. Whether it's climate change, whether it's vaccinations,
they are totalitarians.
Whatever it is.
You're right.
Sorry, exactly. They don't want a discussion. They want to just simply silence you. And it couldn't be anything further from the truth than what we saw from Voltaire. He said, I may disagree with you, but I will defend to the death your right to say what you want to say. They don't want to have that discussion. They want to criminalize it, and they want to censor it. And we see that everywhere. It's one of the things that really concerns me when I look at Gary Johnson. I know that there was a back and forth when you were talking to Jesse Ventura. He's solidly behind Gary Johnson. I don't believe that Gary Johnson is even a libertarian. I don't think the Libertarian Party is libertarian anymore. And I say that as somebody who spent 20 years working with them, who was a lifetime member of the LP. And I'm absolutely disgusted with these people who have sold out
their
principles.
The last few times he was here, Gary Johnson went from, he looks like Emperor Palpatine in the eyes. He's got the little friendly guy act going on, but when you tell him in person, I'd talk to him, he'd be all right during on air, but when I'd talk to him during the breaks, he'd be like, ugh.
Yeah, absolutely.
And it was just like, whoa, and I was like, I don't ever want him on again. Creepy, creepy, creepy. All right, David, God bless you. Nightly News is tonight, 7 o'clock Central. David Knight, straight ahead.
Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show in this fourth hour, Monday, August 29th, 2016, day number 269 with no press conferences from Hillary Clinton. Because, you know, press conferences are like a box of chocolate. You never know what you're going to get. So run, Hillary, run. Run from the questions. Run from the people speaking out at multiple times or flashes that could trigger you into some kind of a issue. I don't know what's going to happen with the debates. It's going to be interesting to see what happens with the debates, because that's not going to go according to script with Donald Trump there. So the debates are going to be very interesting when they happen. But the rest of the press ought to start hitting her on a daily basis. I tell you, every day that I come on, I'm going to give you a daily countdown on how many days it's been since Hillary faced open questions from the press. And they're afraid of her. They won't ask, because they know that if they ask, they'll have their access cut off. And I have to ask you, what does access mean if you can't ask questions? I mean, what good is access? Is it so you can do a selfie with Hillary Clinton? So that you look important asking her softball questions because you're sitting across the table from her, or she's got a call-in? I mean, she even, with Anderson Cooper, she even phoned it in. She did an on-the-phone interview. So I don't know. I guess maybe that makes them look important that they have access to Hillary Clinton. I don't need access to Hillary Clinton to understand what she's about, to report on Hillary Clinton. And I don't actually need to ask her the questions, although it would be interesting to see her taking some questions from some InfoWars reporters. We're not going to see that, though. Okay, she's not going to take questions from anybody. Before I get back to the news, I want to remind you that we have a special 20% off Vitamin Mineral Fusion. And this is the way I prefer to get my multivitamins and minerals. I don't like to take a lot of pills. And that's one of the things when you start trying to take your health seriously, you start looking at the things that you need to supplement that you're not getting in your daily diet. All of a sudden, you start getting all these overlaps and you're taking a big wad of pills. I don't like to do that. I also don't trust that pills are going to be as bioavailable as something that I take in a liquid form. So I would prefer to put all this stuff in a liquid drink, and that's exactly what you get with Vitamin Mineral Fusion. With one of these containers, a daily dose of this will last you for a month. It is loaded with a full month of essential vitamins, minerals, and amino acids that your body needs. You can take a look at our website at InfoWarsLife.com. Take a look at what it has. It's a great tasting mix. And, of course, if you want to, you can make it taste like anything you want. You can mix any kind of fruit or flavoring with these drinks and take your vitamins very easily without swallowing a lot of pills. Get all that in a bioavailable form. And it is 20% off right now at InfoWarsLife.com. You know, we were talking about Gary Johnson and the Libertarian Party because Jesse Ventura was talking about that with Alex Jones. He went on Sunday, and in an interview with Chris Wallace, he said to him, he said, you know, this election cycle is so crazy, if I get into the debates, I might actually win. Could be, but I don't think so. I really don't think so. Once people understand where he's coming from, once they understand that the Libertarian Party is no longer the party of principle, it is another crony capitalist party. If you look at the policies that Gary Johnson and William Weld, two, I would say, people who are more comfortable in the Democrat Party than they are in the Republican Party. Both of them were two-term governors in very Democrat states. Weld in Massachusetts and Gary Johnson in New Mexico. And when he ran 4 years ago, I felt like what he was running on, ignoring things like civil asset forfeiture and the real core issues of the war on drugs. He was pushing marijuana because he wanted to sell it. And he does sell marijuana, or did until he started running. He suspended that business. But the core issues, I felt, he was ignoring and just giving us a warmed-over version of what the Democrats are doing. Now he's actually become a stalking horse for Hillary Clinton. And if you think I'm being too rough on him, if you think I'm saying that he sold out his principles, I mean, go back and look at the Libertarian Party convention when he was adamant that he had to have William Weld with him because William Weld had access to the money men in the Northeast. He had access to Mitt Romney, the two of them friends from being governors in Massachusetts. And William Weld is the old money, the old Ivy League, the old skull and crossbone type of guy. I don't know that he was in skull and crossbone. He's the old Ivy League type of guy that with all the connections to all the big money on Wall Street. And that's what we've seen from Gary Johnson, pandering to the Trans-Pacific Partnership. And let me say this. If you're going to have these so-called partnerships, you know, they used to call them free trade agreements. They were treaties, okay? They weren't about free trade. As Ron Paul used to say, the real libertarian would say, you don't need to have thousands of pages if you're going to have free trade. You just say, hey, you know what? We're not going to tax stuff coming in and out of our countries. That's the agreement that you have. But if you have thousands of pages, you don't have free trade. You have managed trade. If you got 6,000 pages, you've got micromanaged trade. And that's what we have with these trade agreements. When we come back, I want to talk about Gary Johnson reversing his position on vaccines and what that tells us about how they have abandoned libertarianism and the five lame excuses we have when we pass laws. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show on the 269th day since Hillary Clinton has not had a press conference. We're going to hammer that on her every day. And today we find that the healthcare exchanges are falling far short of forecasts. The Washington Post reports, maybe with some concealed glee, although they say this is a grim, though preliminary forecast, they say next year more than one in four counties are at risk of having a single insurer on its exchange. Now, any of you who remember Hillary Clinton as First Lady immediately stepping out and trying to take over a massive segment of the economy, healthcare, and the fact that she kept pushing single payer. And I heard this over and over again as we went to the public meetings, as I stood up and spoke out against it at public meetings. Single payer. That's where we have to go. We can't afford competition. That was what they were telling people. Competition is too expensive. We can't have competition, so we have to have single payer. Obamacare, as Alex Jones has said, and we've all said here at InfoWars many, many times, Obamacare was designed to fail. It was designed to fail. How many years has it been now? 3-4 years since they put this thing through? And it was, I guess, 3 years that they put it through. And already they're collapsing. But they're going to hide the collapse until after the election. They don't want you to know about the next massive waves of increases. This isn't working for the consumer. It's not working for most of the insurance companies because there is no competition. So that's the fundamental lie of Hillary Clinton and the Democrats, that competition is a bad thing. See, on that issue, they're aligned with Rockefeller, who said competition is a sin. Okay, he wanted to drive out all of his competitors. He wanted monopoly pricing. We're talking about Gary Johnson. We're going to go back to him in just a moment. But with all this back and forth about EpiPen prices, okay, understand that she is allowed to do that because she has no competition. The big insurance companies want to coerce you to buy their product, and they want to make sure they are the only ones selling it. Uber wants to coerce, wants to have a monopoly on transportation, on automobiles. They don't want you to own your automobile, and they want you to have to rent from them. That's what all of these guys really want. They talk about how competition is a sin. They all believe that. And, of course, as their paid puppet, Hillary Clinton sells that lie to you as well. Let's look at this with the EpiPen case, for example, okay? Washington Post talks about today that the drug maker, Mylan, who makes EpiPens, is now graciously consented to put out a generic branded EpiPen for half the price, for $300. So first they jack this thing up, okay, to a ridiculously expensive price, and then they say, oh, but that's okay, we'll put one out there, which we still make, but we'll put a generic label on it, and we'll only charge you $300 for it, which is still many times the price that it was just recently. Okay, and they say this will allow Mylan, the company that makes EpiPen, to segment the market because some people will continue to buy the brand name product. Yeah, who would those people be? Those people would be the people who don't have their doctors write them a new prescription. And we're going to talk about how that works in just a moment here. They say the introduction of Mylan's generic also won't automatically open the window to true competition from other generic companies. We've seen this before. Remember, it was just a couple of years ago, if it was that long, maybe it's a year and a half. Remember the pill for AIDS that went from $13.50 to $750 a pill? It was a hedge fund manager who bought Turing Pharmaceutical. And he said, hey, he noticed that they've got this drug, and it's Daraprim. And even though this thing has long since passed into the public domain, essentially, no longer had a copyright, he understood that competitors could not come into existence for many years because of FDA regulations. Do you understand that? This is a drug, this Daraprim, and this is the older case. It was created back in the 1950s. It was not copyrighted anymore. So in theory, you would think, wouldn't you, that other companies could go into competition with them with generics, but that's not the way that it works out. They had a de facto monopoly, and I'm quoting now from Mary Ruart. You see Ruart.com, that's R-U-W-A-R-T. She is a doctor. She is a real libertarian from back in the old days before Gary Johnson took over the party and started changing the principles, jettisoning the principles. But she pointed out that Turing Pharmaceuticals has a de facto monopoly courtesy of the ever-increasing costs of gaining FDA approval, both for new drugs. It costs over $1 billion, and it takes 11 years for your generic to be approved by the FDA. So even though the drug itself is no longer patented, you still have to go through the FDA process of 11 years and $1 billion before you can put something in competition to this guy. That's why he bought the company and raised the price of the pills from $13 to $750 a pill. It's the government. It's the government shutting down competition. And it's the government shutting down competition that is causing our insurance prices to go through the roof for the benefit of a few crony capitalists who are well-connected to people like Hillary Clinton and Barack Obama. That's the truth of what's going on. You can try to blame capitalism about it, but it is a lack of free market. It's a failure to have a free market, not a failure of the free market. Now, what's going on with EpiPen? Again, Mary Ruart points out the truth, and she understands this as a libertarian and as a medical doctor. She says, last October, Sanofi withdrew EpiPen's last true competitor from the market after some suspected device malfunctions. Without competition, Mylan, which makes EpiPen, and they acquired it in 2007, when it was selling for $57, raised their prices to $600 for a two-pack. She says she was actually quoted $800 at her pharmacy. So they get this thing that was about $57. They raise the price to $600. Now they say, after everybody's angry with them, all right, we'll put out a generic brand and we'll only charge you $300. wait a minute. It was $57 not too long ago. Now, they say Teva had submitted, another drug company, had submitted an application for a generic version of EpiPen to the FDA. However, the agency felt, quote, certain major deficiencies, unquote, needed to be addressed. So marketing of EpiPen's new competitor will be delayed until at least 2017. So they got a window of a couple of years, and they're going to cash in on that because there is no competition. Do you understand? There's no competition in healthcare. Everything that big pharmaceuticals and the big insurance companies are doing is using government to shut down competition. They can buy influence with people like Hillary Clinton very easily, and they can shut down competition. Mary Ruart goes on to say, in the meantime, consumers are usually unaware that there's still another less expensive alternative. So if you need EpiPen, listen to me right now, because I'm going to give you a lower cost alternative. It's something called Adrenaclick. It's similar to, but not identical to, EpiPen. It's available for a fraction of the price. But here's what she says. Here's the catch. Be sure you become familiar with it because it has two caps that need to be removed instead of EpiPen's one. Very complicated. Big difference, isn't it? But the FDA will not allow your pharmacist to substitute Adrenaclick unless your doctor rewrites your prescription. See? That's the way FDA works with the big pharmaceutical companies to make them money. So even though this thing has the same level, blood levels of epinephrine, even though it's the same drug, epinephrine, at the same levels, and the dose is the same, because it's a different name, your doctor will have to write you a different prescription. So it's a fraction of the price. It's called Adrenaclick, and that's one way that you can momentarily get around the crony capitalism that we see being pushed through by these regulatory agencies that have become captive to the government. Now, as I pointed out before, Donald Trump, and he doesn't talk about this because he has to speak to people at a fourth grade level, but he has hired people to write his health care reform policy for him. And it is one of the best health care reform policies I've seen. Any libertarian or conservative would love this. Any liberal who understood the fact that the reason these things are expensive is because we don't have competition would love this program. Because what does this program do? This program removes mandates and fatwas from the federal government. It allows us to make choices. It allows us to have tax deductions and money on our own. It allows us to have information about the quality and the cost of health care providers. So we've got all the ingredients there that you need in a marketplace. Oh, and also competition that he was ruthlessly ridiculed for in the debates by Marco Rubio. Every time Donald Trump would start to try to explain it, he'd say, and this is why he has to talk on fourth grade levels, because he started to say, we're going to erase those lines. What are the lines? The lines are the state boundaries. Insurance companies are not allowed to sell insurance across state lines. If free trade is good, all these people who are supporting Obamacare and who are supporting the Trans-Pacific Partnership, all these globalists, all the people at the top of the Republican and the Democrat Party are constantly telling us free trade is great. We got to have free trade. We're not allowed to have free trade on insurance within our own country. How can that be? How can they tell us that free trade is such a great deal? And it is, if it's truly free trade, if it's real competition. And yet what they do is they block competition within America. Remember, the Commerce Clause, lost it there for a moment, the Commerce Clause in the Constitution was set up to prevent precisely the type of situation we have with healthcare right now. It was set up to shut down any kind of trade barriers state to state, any kind of competition state to state. And so they ignore its true function. And instead, they use the Commerce Clause to interject the federal government into areas in which they have absolutely no authority. That's the way the feds run this thing. But if we look at the market situation, and again, as Donald Trump would say, we got to get rid of the lines, the state lines that prohibit competition. And Marco Rubio just, lines, what are you talking about? What's he talking about with the lines? That works when you're talking to four-year-olds, okay? That's why Donald Trump gave up, I think, and said, all right, fine. You can, anybody that can read can go to his site. They can look at the seven-point program that has price transparency that allows you to know what you're going to get in terms of information about the healthcare providers, cost information, success information, as well as giving you health savings accounts, deductions on your income tax. And let's talk about that. They always want to talk about these agendas that they have, like healthcare, for example. If healthcare is so important or education is so important, and they are, why not allow us to take them as credits? Why not allow us to take all of our medical expenses, insurance, our costs as credits and not pay income tax until we have paid for those things that they say are so important? No, it's only important to the extent that they can use it to exert power and control over your life. Otherwise, it's not really very important to them. Now, let's talk about Gary Johnson. Let's talk about mandatory vaccines, because I gave you the real libertarian position on markets and what's really wrong with EpiPen and these other drugs that are there. But let's talk about vaccinations, okay? Gary Johnson has now altered his position. This is the guy who's putting himself out there as a libertarian. And my objection to Gary Johnson being in the debates, I don't like the idea that candidates who are on the ballot in enough states, because it's so difficult to get on the ballot, that's one of the ways that they rig elections. Candidates and parties who are on the ballot in enough states to win ought to be included in the debates, period. And they came up with this ridiculous level of 15%, which comes out of their polls, which they control. And it is grossly unfair. And I agree with them on that. And we fought that as much as we could when we were working in North Carolina with the Libertarian Party. However, my concern with Gary Johnson being in the debates is that he is going to take a word that has finally begun to mean something to people. 25 years ago, when we'd tell people libertarians, they didn't understand what that was. I remember one of the guys who was running for president of the Libertarian Party, his dad got up to endorse him and to put his name in nomination, and his dad thought it was the Libertine Party or the Librarian Party. So it was, that's what we used to get all the time, or the liberals. We would always be called the liberals. They didn't understand the distinction. And now, just as people are starting to understand and see libertarian as meaning somebody who supports individual liberty, we're going to have somebody as the face of libertarianism who is nothing but a corporate crony capitalist pushing a globalist agenda and doing it in order to suck up money for the LP. If they can get 5% of the vote, then they get federal matching funds and they get on the federal tit. Okay? That's what he wants. A pox on them. We used to have the debate, and we used to vote against any libertarian candidate who said that they would even accept federal funds. That has become the entire rationale for the libertarian campaign that they're running this time. That, of course, and probably some kind of deal that they've made with Hillary Clinton, because these two guys, Johnson and Weld, will never say anything bad about Hillary Clinton. It's absolutely amazing. They give her a pass on everything. You talk about sycophants. These two guys are the biggest sycophants. But let's talk about real issues. Let's talk about mandatory vaccination. Johnson had previously held a staunchly, and this is the Libertarian Republic, we have this up at InfoWars. Johnson previously held a staunchly pro-choice position, allowing each individual to choose for himself, each parent to choose on behalf of their child, whether or not to vaccinate. Did you hear that word, that phrase, pro-choice, pro-choice? You realize, of course, that pro-choice to these people doesn't mean anything other than whether you want to kill your child. Just in the realm of the family, pro-choice to them doesn't mean that you get to choose how your child is going to be educated. No, they want to shut down homeschooling. It doesn't mean that you get to choose how you're going, what values you're going to give to your child, or how you're going to feed your child, or even what kind of medical care you're going to be allowed to give your child. No, your children belong to the state, as far as Gary Johnson and these other statists believe, okay? There is no such thing as pro-choice, unless you want to kill your child. And in that case, they'll do everything they can to aid you. As a matter of fact, Gary Johnson said, you know, I recognize the right of a woman to choose. It's the law of the land, blah, blah, blah. We have to respect this right. He said many times, and I've heard this phrase many times, the Libertarian Party, we've got to get government out of the bedroom and out of the boardroom. Well, you know what? They don't want to get government out of your bloodstream, do they? They're going to let government stick you, stick your children with anything that they demand. And this is what he said. Listen to his opinion. He said, in my opinion, this is Gary Johnson speaking, the quote-unquote libertarian. Now, he's the LP candidate. Let's just call it that, the LP. The LP candidate says, in my opinion, this is a local issue. If it ends up being a federal issue, whoa. Wait a minute. First of all, it's not a local issue. The local government doesn't get to tell me what I do with my body, Gary. You want to talk about getting your hands off of our body and leaving women's bodies alone so that they can abort their children? How about getting your hands off of my body when it comes to mandated vaccines, okay? So it's not a local issue. And it doesn't, if it ends up being a federal issue, he says, who would determine that it's a federal issue? Would that be the federal government usurping its power once again? Why can't we have a libertarian candidate who supports the Constitution? He doesn't understand the 10th Amendment. And that's understandable because he doesn't understand the 2nd Amendment either. He and his candidate, William Wells, supported an assault weapon ban. Okay? The guy he demanded to have on the ticket with him supported an assault weapon ban in Massachusetts. They don't understand or value or respect the Constitution. And they don't respect the 10th Amendment either. If it ends up being a federal issue, there is nothing in the Constitution that says the federal government can dictate your medical care. They can't dictate whether or not you get insurance even. And of course, that was taken care of when we had a federal judge, a Supreme Court judge, Roberts, being blackmailed, writing both the dissenting and the concurring opinion. Don't tell me Roberts wasn't blackmailed. That was open corruption. He said, if it came down to be a federal issue, I would come down the side of science and require the vaccine. He ignores individual rights. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. In our last segment here, I want to finish up on this whole idea of mandatory vaccine. And I want to cover something from the Foundation for Economic Education. Again, a real libertarian publication. They talk about five lame excuses for passing laws. And I'm going to give you those five excuses. You've heard them all. And this is a classic article that really nails it. Before we do, real quickly, I want to remind you, we've got a sale on Vitamin Mineral Fusion drink mix. It's 20% off right now at InfoWarsLife.com. Again, this is in each of these containers, you get a full month's supply of essential vitamins, minerals, and amino acids that you can drink. You don't have to take a lot of pills. You can drink this. It makes it very bioavailable. All of these are plant-derived or the highest quality lab standard. And you get vitamin C, vitamin E, zinc, magnesium, selenium, glutamine, alpha-lipoic acid, folic acid, calcium, and many others that I won't bother to try to murder how fast those. But you get the full list you can see at InfoWarsLife.com. A great way to get your multivitamin supplementation, vitamins and minerals in a great tasting drink mix, 20% off right now at InfoWarsLife.com. Now, what are the five lame excuses for passing laws? Number one, the biggest one, protect the children. That's what we see with the mandatory vaccines, right? Protect the children. In other words, the government, uncle, is the parent. Get over the idea that these children belong to you. They're not your kids. They belong to the village, and they're going to be the only ones who can protect them. And all this stuff that they're going to do is just to protect the children. Number two, the slippery slope, okay? marijuana is going to be the slippery slope to drug addiction and so forth. Number three is for our safety. Always sacrifice your liberty for safety. Remember, it's always the promise of safety. Because you know what? Slaves are never free. And they're also never safe, is what I meant to say. Slaves are never safe, okay? If you're going to give up your freedom, to that degree, you're going to be a slave. Slaves are never safe. Number four, they're going to prevent bad choices for you. And of course, they will define what the bad choices are. And number five, it's the law. In other words, I say so. Even when they don't have a law that allows them to do that. Just as we saw with Gary Johnson saying, well, you know, I think it's a vaccinations or a local issue, but if it becomes a federal issue, and it's like, there is no legitimacy to it becoming a local issue if you're going to stand for individual rights. And there's certainly, under the Constitution, there is no legitimacy for vaccinations, mandatory vaccinations, becoming a federal issue. Okay, but let's look at what he's been pushing with the rest of this stuff, okay? He's been pushing things like carbon credits. We mentioned this when this came out briefly, and of course, Daily Caller has talked about it. The Mises, .org has talked about it. We carried that article at Infowars.com. Many people have pointed out to Gary Johnson, Gary, there is no free market carbon tax. That's what he's saying. He says, I believe in man-made global warming, Gary Johnson says, and we have to do something about it. And so I think we need to have a free market approach. So I'm going to put a fee on carbon dioxide emissions. Now, remember, we had Mitt Romney running, and he talked about how, oh, I cut all these taxes. I didn't raise any taxes. And people said, look at all these fees you imposed on people. Oh, he said, Mitt Romney, fees are not taxes. Remember that? Remember that lie that he had? Fees are not taxes. Gary Johnson, I guess William Weld from Massachusetts, friend of Mitt Romney, was telling him, tell people that it's just a fee. Don't tell them it's a tax, okay? Don't tell them that we're going to rob this activity over here in order to subsidize or mandate this other activity over here. You know, it is not a free market solution to put carbon taxes on it. It is a globalist, crony capitalist solution. And that's what Gary Johnson's become. That's it for our broadcast. Join us tonight for the InfoWars Nightly News, 7 Central, 8 p.m. Eastern.